your host, Alex Jones. We'll be here for the next 4 hours. We have former Congressman Ron Paul joining us. We have Gavin McGinnis joining us, Anthony Cumia joining us. We have David Knight also co-hosting in and hosting in the fourth hour. We have our reporters on the West Coast that saw another night of rioting and police and press and innocent citizens being attacked. We've got those videos. We have Katie Couric caught red-handed editing a gun documentary to make gun owners look like idiots. This is so illustrative of deception. That ties into a huge new Glenn Beck deception where we've got him red-handed. So it's bigger than Glenn Beck or Katie Couric. It's about understanding people like Brian Williams. These are three peas in a pod. That's why they're all three falling apart. But first, record lines this Memorial Day coming up, and the TSA is demanding more money, or they're going to shut down all transport on planes, basically. This is terrorism.
The TSA, a monstrosity of bloated George Bush-era New World Order policy resulting from the nefarious relationship between the Bush family and the Saudis. This relationship has forced Rand Paul to file an amendment to the National Defense Authorization Act mandating that the 28 classified pages of the 9/11 report be released within 60 days of the NDAA being signed into law later this year. Meanwhile, the TSA costs the taxpayers in the ballpark of $7 billion annually. Money spent on a long, embarrassing track record resulting in Homeland Security being successful in smuggling guns and bombs through TSA security 67 out of 70 times. Loaded guns still pass right through the TSA, as happened in Atlanta recently, not to mention the fact that you have a pretty good chance of being robbed by a TSA agent. RT reported that a TSA agent convicted of stealing more than $800,000 worth of goods from travelers said this type of theft is commonplace among airport security. Almost 400 TSA officers have been fired for stealing from passengers since 2003. But there we are, standing in long lines, each one of us having our Fourth Amendment rights violated and our tax dollars squandered, while the borders remain wide open as drug traffickers, child rapists, and terrorists surge through the unprotected property of American citizens while the Border Patrol is ordered to stand down. Meanwhile, as many as 4,000 flyers missed their flights on American Airlines from February of this year alone. Got it? Illegal aliens move freer than American citizens, and we are paying for it.
The borders are open. And we have mainstream news articles admitting that they fly in planes to New York every day out of Mexico and other countries, and no one is even checked. No IDs are even looked at. Congress approves TSA request for screeners to meet summer crush. They're going to get an additional $34 million to hire an additional 768 new officers and pay overtime for 42,000 plus.
So what does the establishment do? The House Committee on Oversight and Government Reform fired Kelly Hogan, the TSA's chief of security, mainly because Hogan, who was paid $181,000 a year, received $90,000 in bonuses, regardless of the fact that TSA had been recently revealed to be a complete failure. As if that fixes the problem. And the only recourse for the airlines as Memorial Day weekend looms is for the airlines to take over the gridlock. Bloomberg reports American, Delta, and United Airlines will spend as much as $4 million each for extra workers at their busiest airports to help manage lines and shuffle bins at checkpoints, freeing up TSA officers to focus on screening. Carriers and airports also are diverting some of their own employees to take the load off TSA staff. You want a solution? Shut down the TSA and reinvigorate the spirit of the American people by restoring the Fourth Amendment. Terrorists want to take a plane over? Well, our Second Amendment rights have a pretty simple fix for that. Of course, I admit, a shootout at 35,000 feet isn't the smartest solution. So if the bureaucracy must continue, take that $7 billion spent on the TSA annually and expand and modify the highly trained Sky Marshal Service into an agency that actually obeys the Bill of Rights. Because right now, the only thing the TSA provides is a guaranteed false sense of security to protect the travelers who are being set up for disaster by an alphabet agency expanding its grip on the very freedom and security the TSA supposedly protects. John Bound for Infowars.com.
I will have to be extremely disciplined today to cover even half of the vitally important news and information we have to break down. but I'm going to give it my best attempt here. Former Congressman Ron Paul will be joining us to start the second hour. And we have Gavin McGinnis also joining us and Anthony Cumia for analysis on political correctness and world events. David Knight will be hosting the fourth hour. And I believe that we also have John McAfee popping in with him. There's a special report I filed yesterday that I think is excellent that we're going to be playing later in this hour. It's up on Infowars.com. It needs to go extremely viral. Video: Trump exposes globalist coup inside America. Elite in full panic mode. I'm going to change that headline that I came up with right now. Video: Trump exposes globalist coup over America. Elite in full panic mode. Because it is an elitist coup over America. A globalist coup. And here's what's happening. People are becoming aware of it, and the old dominant dinosaur media is officially dead. They now know that, so they're coming to try to sell the idea of censoring and controlling and intend to try to use the Federal Elections Commission, the FCC, Homeland Security, and others to do it. They intend to use the Department of Justice to go out and arrest governors and attorney generals that stand up to Obama and the agenda. They're arresting filmmakers. They're persecuting pastors. They are putting people in jail for having dinosaur creation parks in Florida. Whether you believe that dinosaurs walked with humans or not, someone should have the right to say the world is round or the world is flat. But this is the type of stuff going on, and they have shows on HBO going, yeah, lock these crazies up. Lock them up. They had a big story on Monday. We've covered it in the Washington Post. Big old, huge, thick, 30-something page report saying they're armed, they're dangerous, they're constitutionalists, they're the biggest threat. Arrest them. Because you've lost the viewers, you've lost the people's heart, you've lost the people's trust, you've broken the social contract, you're not liberals, you're anti-free speech authoritarians, you are allied with the establishment Republicans who are just as authoritarian, and the American people have taken the gloves off. And I'm here to tell you something. You may balkanize people against each other along religion and race. You may try to get more of the public dependent on welfare and systems to control them. But at the end of the day, historically, and looking at current trends as well, and even reading your own white papers, your own top advisors like Brzezinski tell you it is impossible to control populations. You just have to kill everybody. And when your own minions find out that that's the plan, to start world wars and release bioweapons, that you're actually looking at that to maintain your fraudulent control, people aren't going to go along with you when the rubber meets the road, especially if you start pulling the trigger on the final phases of your emergency plans, your backup plans. We aren't being caught flat-footed. We're being caught on our toes in a fighting stance. We are the culture. Patriots, through newsletters, magazines, talk radio, speaking at churches, colleges, writing books, you name it, for 60-plus years, really longer than that. If you go back to the Lindberghs and others fighting the private Federal Reserve, but really for 60 years, the Liberty Movement has been on target opposing globalism and the globalist project because they were scholars, they were military men and women, they were constitutional lawyers, they were governors, they were serious people that were inside the system and who the globalists tried to recruit. When you read Barry Goldwater's quotes in his book, No Compromise, it's right there where he describes the Trilateral Commission plan to take over America and set up regional governments worldwide and destroy national sovereignty, to take over the churches, banking, industry, and the universities, and they've done it. This is a real plan. But it counts on you being so ignorant and mainstream media making fun of researchers that pointed out that it's been hidden in plain view. Like the White House science czar, John P. Holdren, 42 years ago, the year I was born, wrote a U.S. government-sponsored 1,100-page textbook for PhDs and above on how to social engineer, how to break up the family, how to fluoridate the water, to brain damage you. I mean, at a controller level, they've got to have a book where they go, this is really what we're doing. It's the size of the Dallas phone book when I was a kid, a huge phone book. That's just one book. Tragedy and Hope, The Technotronic Era. There are countless ones where they openly write books. Men in Power is a political retrospective. Helmut Schmidt, German Chancellor. And I've read or scanned over. I've read probably 20 of these books they've written. I've scanned through, you know, with bibliographies, hundreds of books. I mean, I can't just sit through the same dribble over and over again. But I've scanned over hundreds of books. I've read 20-plus books written by them or more. That's a conservative number. And they just think you're so stupid. And every time I talk to a globalist, they go, you notice, Alex, that even though we're public about this, the public doesn't care. No, the public does care. They get bullied and ridiculed every time they talk about these issues, or the media spins and lies. And so people feel like they're alone and intimidated, but not anymore, because anybody can put on an InfoWars.com t-shirt and go out and walk down the street and have people stop them and shake their hand. So we're reaching a critical point. And InfoWars is only one part of that. Obviously, Hillary is in big trouble. Significant security risk. State Department says Clinton violated email security rules. So that's a big slap in the face for her. We could be beginning to see the beginning of the end of Hillary Clinton. I've been smelling it. I've been smelling it for months. But regardless, the truth is coming out. I mean, she just can't hide her lies in plain view and get away with it forever. Obama has come out and said world leaders are right to be rattled, close quote, by Donald Trump. What an endorsement to have world leaders that have sold us out to globalism rattled. We are also going to get into AAA says Memorial Day travel volume will be second highest on record as the TSA holds the public, as the federal government holds the public hostage, saying give us more funding to set up highway checkpoints and other things, or we won't put enough screeners at the airports to, quote, engage in security theater. But John Bowne filed a very powerful report that we aired earlier today here at the very start of the broadcast that's up on InfoWars.com titled Shut Down the TSA Enough Already, where we prove that the borders are wide open, that the jihadis are brought in without even having passports, and that all of that is A-OK, but citizens have to be trained to take their shoes off, their belts off, and to be pre-screened or pre-approved. But still, if you're pre-approved, you can still be shunted through the security line, preparing you to be a prisoner, that you're guilty until proven innocent, when the answer is arm the pilots, or for a fraction of the price, stick a air marshal on every passenger plane out there. You could do it for $300, $400 a flight, it's estimated. Boom, fine, game over, armed person on the plane. Can sit right up there, you know, with the pilots if you want. And that ends it. That ends it right there, and they know that. Oh, we can't trust pilots. They only fly the big giant plane. Well, look out, because they want to go to everything being drone operated, and that gives the globalists total control over all of society. The military is coming out and saying we want all of our convoys now to be autonomous, to be driverless, because then terrorists won't blow them up. Oh, well, we want all of our combat troops to be robots, because then terrorists won't kill them. Humans are being taken out of the equation to turn us into servile, screenhead, wirehead zombies. Not being challenged, not working out, not facing combat, not being involved, not being forced to go give a speech or to try to get an A+, or to play dodgeball or to play volleyball. Well, because I might lose. All that's being phased out, because they don't want you to ever experience anything that takes you through stress to a higher level. That's why our IQs are dropping. It's why our health is imploding. The federal government came out, the CDC, and said we're fatter than ever today. And that ties in to this report. CDC, Americans are fatter than ever before. I'll cover this coming up. U.S. Army to test driverless vehicles, technology in Michigan. That all ties together. And then that ties in with this. Professor, if you read to your kids, you're unfairly disadvantaging others. National Review that I mentioned yesterday. When you read deeper, it actually says the family's bad, but we're going to allow it to be around for a little bit longer. And that ties into this new article today. Oberlin students want to abolish midterms and any grades below C. You see there? Oh my gosh, you read to your kids, they're too advantaged. We need to ban private school. We need to get rid of the family. This is ABC News interviewing a professor saying this with a straight face. And now we need to get rid of anything below a C. You see where this is going by design. The world is being set up where we're obsolete by design. We are the dominant species. Humans build their own environment. That's what makes us different. But instead, the elite are taking control of our development and building an environment that makes us obsolete and makes us dumb and makes us weak. In Bill Joy's own words in 1999 in Wired Magazine, Sun Microsystems owner, he said, I went to an elite meeting with 200 top owners. We said, do we just keep humans alive in mass and let them play games all day? Or do we just exterminate everybody? And he said, the answer is extermination. He said, I just think I might want to tell the public this. They're going to build a technocracy where you're obsolete and they plan to kill you. And people said, oh, that's a funny article. So they're already killing us slowly right now. Don't say you weren't warned. We'll be back. I'm about to, in this segment and for part of the next, break down hardcore deception in the media. Will it make it easy? And then I'm going to tie that into how this is an overall public destabilization program. But just to illustrate that, during the break, I've never seen Leanne McAdoo in 4 years of knowing her so hot, one of our reporters. I don't mean so beautiful. She's always beautiful. I mean so angry, hot under the collar. They said, hey, Leanne wants to come on during the break before. And I said, okay. And then she comes stomping in here and shows me KXAN TV, NBC, and the Austin American Statesman and others, and is just so angry because the Alamo Draft House has revolutionized dinner theaters. They do it on a big scale. I know Ken Lee back when he founded the first one. I've been showing my films there since he first founded them back in, you know, I guess it was like 1999 or something. And now they're all over the country. It's based here in Austin. It's dinner and a movie. I don't care if the guy's liberal. He's produced movies that have characters, you know, that are based on myself. I've gone and, you know, been a guest and spoken at some of the premieres. And he has a lot of big actors that come into town. The guy's an American success story. So I'm going to cover the media deception in the next segment. I'm going to cover this a little bit now. She's going to be in studio with us later. She walked in and she said, I'm really mad about this. And I said, yeah, they're going to retrofit the Alamo Draft House and have it where men and women's bathrooms can be everybody in everybody's bathrooms. Women are still, I said to her, don't worry, going to self-segregate and go to the women's, and men's are going to the men's. I mean, it's like a cattle call after a movie or before one to even get into a movie theater bathroom. You want it to go as fast as possible. It's just getting, you know, a bodily function done. But the government's jacking with our physiology to totally confuse us and mess with us. You think it's bad for adults in the social engineering? Imagine what it's like for kids. And she goes, read the article. And I said, okay, you're so angry. She was red-faced. She said, read it. And I went, oh, my gosh. Let me show you this right now if you're a TV viewer. Oh, my gosh. This is the next phase. Document cam, please. The headline should be Alamo Drafthouse Theaters to make women pee standing up. That's the real headline. They have the blueprints. They want to jack with people so hard, they're getting rid of toilets, except for a few stalls. In social, they're already getting rid of water at some of them, saying humans are bad, eco-friendly. I don't know if Ken Lee knows this is eugenics. You know, he's like guilty. He's a capitalist making hundreds of millions of dollars or whatever. And so he's just going to adopt, you know, the 200-square-foot apartments Austin's getting and just everything else. And don't say the word mother or father. And every movie has to have a woman as the hero. But now they have urinals where women have to pee standing up. See, they're just phasing out culture. They're phasing out electricity. They're phasing out big apartments and big houses. They're social engineering us to have less, but the elite are going to have more while they lecture us. And this is as all these different governors in 12 states, it was 10, it's two more in the last few hours, sue Obama over gender-neutral bathrooms and gender-neutral prisons. They're now having to build new prisons. New detainment facilities for illegals. That's been announced. The feds are building a huge facility in Texas for something like $30 million. I mean, you thought it bankrupted everything to put a wheelchair ramp into, say, a tiny bed and breakfast that has two rooms. They just go bankrupt. The big corporations love that. This is the tyranny of zoning. And just like the left in Austin is so freaked out that Uber and Lyft that got there in 2 or 3 minutes every time, I always had a great experience with it. It was just night and day. The taxi cab service in Austin, Texas, the whole time I've lived here has been horrible. It's so bad that I won't even use it. 90% of the time until I quit using it a few years ago, they don't even send a cab the first time. You have to get it like an hour and a half earlier, and then the second or third try, they come. Now they tell you, oh, I don't want to come where you're at, and I don't want to go there. You get cab services in London. It's all foreigners, and they tell you, I want triple price to take you to the hotel. You ask the next person, they go, triple price. They've got everything rigged. That's okay. You like losing your Uber and your Lyft? How about losing your businesses? How about now where, okay, you want to go to a woman's, that's fine. You want to go to a man's, however you identify, whatever. That's going to cause problems. But now, oh no, we're getting rid of the toilets and we're going to make everybody, by the way, the word is they're coming out with new toilets where you also stand and take a crap. And look, I'm sorry to talk about body functions here on air. I never used to do that, but that's what our sick freakoid government's into. And it's happening in Europe and everywhere else to ruin culture. The truth is they're not sick in that they're obsessed with potties and sex and all this. They want to get us obsessed with that, where we're just a bunch of confused, mentally ill, basket case, social justice warriors that can hardly talk and are waging war against communication and against language and against everything else. This is total divide and conquer. But look at it right here. It actually says right here, women will have to urinate standing up. They're just going to get rid of toilets. And the Alamo Draft House wants to be cutting edge. All right, Congressman Ron Paul's coming up on huge issues, the economy, 2016, globalism, and so much more. We've also got a bunch of other guests. Leanne McAdoo is going to be popping back in about an hour and a half to really flesh this out when Anthony Kumi is on with us, popular syndicated talk show host. But if you're a new viewer, I'm not kidding about what I just covered, so she's popping in right now. They have the blueprints out, and Ken Lee, who I've known for, gosh, it's got to be like 18 years. He used to love me. Now when I see him, I run him down the street. He goes, oh, Alex, hi, and just walks around me, totally freaked out. He's totally in the liberal cult, absolutely, completely following whatever they say. And when you read the KXAN article with his quotes from NBC News here that I'm about to show TV viewers and read for radio listeners, you have to understand, everything he's saying is an inversion of what this is designed. Notice when you hear him talk, it's everything I've said but the opposite. Now, I don't know if he's in on this or he knows he's been given talking points, but Ken, I don't think you're a bad guy. I mean, I've been to movie premieres where they have, you know, big actors that he's produced. He produces big films now, and the character's based on me. I mean, and I'm happy that's happened. I mean, I've hung out and had dinner with this guy. And it's just crazy that he's the cutting edge. He said, we've heard about transgender kids getting beat up in bathrooms. Oh, where? You know, I mean, Ken League, Tim League, whatever. I can't, it's teleprompter free. Tim League. And all of this is going on. It's totally out of control. It blows my mind that this is happening. And they, again, invert reality. Tim League is inverting reality. I don't know if Tim League is doing this on purpose. I've known the guy for years, as I said. But listen to how they twist this information. Alamo Drafthouse seeks feedback on gender-neutral bathroom design. Like when they caught the gay preacher putting fag on the cake, they just said, oh, he's nicely dropping his lawsuit. He's such an angel, was the KXAN and Austin American Statesman headlines. Yeah. They wouldn't tell you he'd been caught lying and they had surveillance footage. It was just, he's so gracious and he's loving. So there's deception in the headline to make it look normal. Here it is. It's all psychological warfare. Alamo Drafthouse seeks feedback on gender-neutral bathroom design. Then you read it. It's the opposite of gender-neutral. The Alamo Drafthouse has classic bathrooms, big area for women, big area for men, already big lines, already a disaster. This is going to be an even bigger disaster. So he's decided at their new location here in Austin, the Mueller location, to scrap it. And he says, because we want to, quote, hopefully remove design conflict. So he goes on to say, you can't necessarily change everybody's mind immediately on these issues, but you can hopefully, by design, eliminate conflict. Putting men and women together in restrooms will create conflict. Everyone knows it. It's social engineering to stir everybody up and bring down culture and society. That's the admitted globalist blueprint. The working draft, which was posted on Facebook, is one large bathroom with a section of urinals behind a door and individual stalls for seated toilets. League said he is considering a type of urinal both men and women can use. Because you're going to have one bathroom now, folks. You won't be able to go to the Alamo Draft House. I will not go and stick my little girls and my son in a freak show bathroom because you just want to control reality. But it's their religion, so he can't help it. I predict he'll bankrupt Alamo franchise before he stops. So what does an all-gender urinal look like? It's new territory, says Weiss. It's something we're looking into. It's essentially a urinal that has a throat that comes out.
It's a deeper
stall. It's a deeper stall. So women squat now. I mean,
well,
Leanne.
No, we just sort of bring ourselves standing above this urinal. As a woman, I was so frustrated.
But to get rid of conflict.
Yeah.
This will cause total bedlam, total Tower of Babel, total absolute insanity. I mean,
It's tyranny of the minority.
Listen, I won't go to a gas station that has a crappy bathroom, even if I only use it once a year. If I know that gas station has a bad bathroom, I will not pump gas there because I just think of the whole place is gross. Now, because of this, just they already put these low flush toilets and environmental toilets in with no water, so the place smells like year old 50,000 gallons of cat piss. So I already can't go to Alamo Draft House South Lamar because the place into the hall smells like a giant cat piss hell. So it's now Alamo cat piss. And now Leanne and everybody else and my daughters are not going up to some dirty funnel spout and sticking their butts in it because you want to play God. Now I know why you're so angry. But these people are cult leaders. They will have us drinking purple Kool-Aid with frickin' cyanide by the time they're done. I'm sorry, Leanne. I called you in here. Now I know why you're mad. Go ahead. But look, it ties in with this. Professor, if you read to your kids, you're unfairly disadvantaging others. Then they go on to say, we're not getting rid of the family completely yet, but it's bad, and private schools should be banned. I have another article. Oberlin students want to abolish midterms and any grades below C. We are being destroyed. We are being brain damaged. We are being annihilated. No, go ahead. I'm sorry, Leanne.
Tyranny of the minority. Tyranny by the minority. And this made me so angry because we've completely...
Check your male white privilege.
We've gone completely past gender-inclusive bathrooms to physics-defying bathrooms. Women are not made to pee standing up. And why, why all of a sudden do women now have to change the way that they go to the bathroom?
These people are loons. They're control freaks. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
It's just, it's so frustrating to me. This
Tim League. I'm so angry I can't even talk. Literally is obsessing over how we pee-pee.
Yeah. Well, I demand that Tim League redesign his bathrooms to be inclusive for the men who live as dogs. So really, he should just put fire hydrants in there.
That's in the Guardian. I agree. How about we all just have a big commons area at the entrance by the bar at Alamo Draft House Theaters, and everyone just comes in and urinates on fire hydrants?
Yeah. I mean, we just have a giant gaping hole in the floor.
And have big old AstroTurf area.
Yeah.
Where we take...
And they could have little pooper scoopers come around and just follow us all around.
That'll be a new job. How prestigious. Hey, you know Alamo Draft House South Lamar, the times I've been in there now, smells like a urinal out in the hall.
Yeah. I mean...
Because they put the no water thing in there.
Right. And then, like, urinal cakes. I don't want those in the bathroom. Those things are disgusting and they smell terrible. Like, what are they thinking? I mean, as a woman, I am so frustrated that as soon as...
They're teaching us to be poor and they're destroying civilization. That's Agenda 21. It's a battle plan on record for post-industrial world, Tim League.
Talk about oppression by the patriarchy. So now...
Can we get a clip of Copper Cab when he sings, saying, patriarchy rules the world, to check your male white privilege. I'm sorry.
And now I got to check my female white privilege, my woman privilege, because now... That women have penises, we have to actually redesign the way the actual women go to...
You know, I shouldn't be laughing. This is horrifying. And we're on a lot of great Christian stations around the country that have picked us up for decades. And they know we don't get into potty stuff. But the government's taking over the potties and they're coming after our kids. I have to talk about
it. Yeah. Well, if you de-sex society, you dehumanize society. And that's what this is really all about. You've been talking about this for a long time. It's not about... gender inclusivity. It's about redefining what sex is, what gender is. And we're just at the beginning of this. How far are they going to take this? I mean, we are just at the beginning of this whole transgender thing, and they're already making federal laws where you can be fined if you refuse to call someone they. You know, I mean,
they want to arrest you 5 years in prison in Canada if you say you don't believe in transgenderism. Well, I mean, how about I believe the moon's made of cheese, whether I'm wrong or right? Do I have free speech or not? And now, I mean, listen, I'm not kidding. But see, they're saying, oh, yeah, it'll be all next is going to be our houses, restaurants, our homes. You watch with all the zoning where Germany 6 years ago passed a law saying no new single home dwellings in Germany. People didn't believe it. Now Austin's talking about doing that.
Yeah.
They're actually social engineering the standard biology of humans out of existence. This is a takeover. This is a plan. This isn't a game.
Well, and this also is a total oppression by the patriarchy because you're forcing women to accommodate the male anatomy. You're completely changing the women's comfort. We don't
matter. That's the plan. They're going to cause a debate with this nationwide and say, we're sorry, we're going to make you all sit down now. Watch.
Oof.
I've got them. This is Hegelian dialectic.
I actually had a breakup with a guy because I found out that he peed sitting down. Sorry. That might be offensive, but...
Well, a lot of people's mommies make them do that so they don't...
Exactly.
You know, if you sprinkle, when you tinkle, be a sweetie, lift the seedie.
Yeah. Well, and here's the other thing. So they're taking out textbooks that if there's any kind of debate about the whole climate, man-made climate change and stuff, well, how come science is like 100% on that? But now all of a sudden science got it wrong on there's only two sexes?
I like what you say about their blood people now that say they're dogs. Let's show this.
Yeah.
And so we shouldn't be able to say dog because maybe some people don't have a dog, like boy or girl. But I think actually the Alamo Drafthouse should put in a big AstroTurf and fire hydrants. And we'll just say, well, you're all dogs when you come here. And the folks that want to go there and, you know...
Maybe via evolution, we will just change the way that all of us. Well, they'll.
I mean, that woman doesn't look completely insane right there.
No, she's very happy taking care of her husband.
See, they take your freedom. They take your rights away. They take your health away. We're a bunch of mentally ill, obese people on average now. People with record levels of cancer. But they give us insanity. That's the new right we're given is cultural degradation and the collapse of humanity. And Tim League can make hundreds of millions of dollars and prance around, and that's okay, but he wants to look at making women stand while urinating. And look, I'm sorry to have to talk about this. This is not a subject we get into, but now we're being culturally taken over, and this is the attack. Leanne, you'll be back with us in a couple hours. Thank you so much. Amazing, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I've got to get back to my hardcore news, but I was already planning to get into all the transgender news and the 12 states suing and... While this is going on, our economy's falling apart. While our power plants are being shut off, we can't compete. I mean, we are being shut down right now. You want to see 21st century warfare? This is it. Telling women to urinate standing up. Telling people we're going to go tell your five-year-olds that they can be confused and can be male or female or maybe a dog or, you know, banning dodgeball, banning tag, banning the words mother and father, he and she on admission forms. It's here. It's going on. It's a cult. They mean business. And then half the time they bust these Congress people and leaders of different federal agencies are hardcore pedophiles. I mean, with like three-year-old kids and stuff. Of course, who else would want to make women use weird urinals? But a bunch of freaks. And then you got all the intimidated, basically cult members of liberalism who mean well, many of them, probably like Tim League. I don't think he's a bad guy. Who just, okay, we'll put in urinals for women, whatever you say, and we'll all put everyone in the same bathroom. I'm not going to the Alamo Draft House on the off chance I got to go number two, and I'm going to go in there and go, hey, how you doing, ma'am? Pull my pants down in front of women. I already don't want to do that in front of men. And again, I've never in 21 years on air talked about private stuff like this, but you want to get it all out in the open, you perverts? We're doing it now. I am so fed up with these people. I am so absolutely fed up with it. I am sick of them. There you go. I am boycotting the Alamo Draft House. I'm not going there again until they apologize and pull this out. I've done repeatedly the deal at the start of the movie where they say, don't talk on your cell phone or I'm going to take you out. I've done that, I think, three times over the years. I mean, I've showed my films there. I know these people, and they have gone completely nuts, and I'm done. I'm sorry, I'm not taking my son to stick him in a bathroom with other women and men, and I'm not taking my daughters to stick them in a bathroom where they learn to pee like a dog. I mean, I'm not even boycotting you. I can't get close to you. I can't get near you. And all your unhappy, desperate trendies that run it, who are so empty and so soulless and so unhappy. That's it. Never going again. Boom. Hope you enjoy it. Because you're not going to stop. You're in a cult. It's like Target lost $3, $4 billion when they came out and said they're going to integrate the bathrooms. And they just said, we're not stopping. We don't care. Because this is a plan, a program, an operation. They've all got to lockstep together and not have any link in the chain fail in their con game, in their takeover, in their plan. Now, let's shift gears very briefly here. Then I'm getting into the deception of the media. They're putting estrogen mimickers in the food and water. They're jacking with people. They're attacking our sex. I just covered that. That's what this is all about, is ending the species. 90% of the sperm in the West are dead or immobile. Women are incredibly infertile. You're being hit, and you're being hit hard. And one thing is the estrogen mimickers. What I counter it with is super male and super female vitality. Both have been sold out for months. They're our number one products. They just came back in yesterday. Get super male vitality, concentrated cold-pressed herbs, and an incredible fusion to just energize your life. That's what I've experienced. I'm not going to go over what all these well-known documented herbs do, but nobody else has the patented process that Dr. Group does of the cold pressing and then the aging of it. They don't heat it up, but they age it and then let it dry out and then keep adding more. It's more complex than that, but it's super, 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 super concentrated. And most people feel libido, energy, stamina within 24 hours. But talk to your physician first. Super Male Vitality is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. InfoWarsStore.com is the umbrella site. Filter your water. It's full of glyphosate and estrogen mimicker. It's full of hundreds of other chemicals. The Alexa Pure, the Pro Pure, the different systems we have are all excellent. And they're the best gravity-fed systems out there. They're apples and oranges, but they're all good. And they're the lowest prices you're going to find. InfoWarsStore.com, promo code WATER. 10% off. Vitamin Mineral Fusion with amino acids is back in. The Fruit Punch to get your kids and yourself and everybody else off the soft drinks and the garbage and to get the vitamins and minerals you need in a truly absorbable, plant-based, organic form. It is a true game changer. Vitamin Mineral Fusion, InfoWarsLife.com. And you can get 10% off when you sign up for auto ship on any of the products and free shipping on orders of $50 or more. We're also in closing. In closing, no, I'm not going to skip this break. I've got to stop skipping the breaks. I might when Ron Paul's on, so I just stop right there. Sounds like I'm talking to myself. I just hit the cough button and told him I'm going to skip the break, but now I'm not going to. I just can't do it. Here's what I'm getting at. The bad halogen is out there. There's a whole bunch of them. Look at the informational videos at InfoWarsLife.com. Read the papers. Do your own research. Talk to your physician. Your nutritionist, the bad halogens are there. They fill up your glands. It just totally shuts you down. So many problems. If you've got good halogen, they can't get into your glands at the same levels. It helps push the bad stuff out as well. Some people go through a detox in 3 weeks, so consult your physician, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. And lastly, if you sign up for the free newsletter, you get exclusive articles, videos, a list of key news and intel, great to send on to friends and family and neighbors, and communicate in the info war, but you can expand on that and also notice that every day there are different promo codes, sometimes 10%, sometimes 20%, sometimes 30%, sometimes like we did with the Hillary for Prison shirts, 50% off with promo codes for InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com. So that's another reason to be signed up at InfoWars.com/newsletter. Just put your email in, boom, and you can get off at any time you want. Check it out today. And I shot a new video breaking that down that we're going to get up on the email site that I shot on Monday. We're going to get that video up there so I can break down some of the other benefits for you at InfoWars.com/newsletter. Now, we're going to go to break. And when we come back, I'm going to try to be as quick as I can about this because I don't want to spend all my time on Glenn Beck. But the fall of Glenn Beck, the political death of Glenn Beck has not been exaggerated. To paraphrase a patriot of old. But we are certainly going to go over it because he's come out yet again and said that they didn't have veiled threats at Matt Drudge. or that, you know, they're not sitting there lying about Matt Drudge and veiled threats on Donald Trump. Stay with us. We'll be right back. There is a video up on Infowars.com. It's a clip of Glenn Beck yesterday saying one of the most deceptive things I've ever heard, period. It's one of these lies that's so twisted it's hard to even describe, where he goes, finally, the mainstream media is doing something I've called for years. They're battling dangerous conspiracy theorists and these type of right-wingers. And he goes, it's incredible. They're exposing the lies that people claim that Vince Foster was murdered. I mean, there's so much evidence, it's incredible. And so he's acting like mainstream media never said Vince Foster wasn't murdered, or that the CIA didn't invent the term conspiracy theory back in the 50s and 60s to discredit people. That's been declassified in the Senate Church Committee hearings. So Glenn Beck proves Vince Foster's death a suicide, not is our joke. Trusted source Jake Tapper has Beck convinced there was no foul play. It's him worshiping CNN. It's so bizarre. But saying no one had ever said Vince Foster committed suicide, that all these kooks were saying it was murder, and that only Glenn Beck had said it was really suicide. I mean, it is just total establishment behavior, but saying it's anti-establishment. So then it gets worse. Story up on Infowars.com. Beck calls Drudge evil for suggesting he advocated Patriot kill Donald Trump. Now, again, we're not obsessing on him because he's Glenn Beck. We're obsessing on this because this is how they deceive. In the next segment, before Ron Paul comes on, I'm going to get to Katie Couric clips, where a whistleblower inside the maker of this documentary film, she goes, you give me a reason guns, you know, protect people and what they would have done. And she cuts to them sitting there when they were rolling, but didn't know they were being asked a question, and they all look dumb. They've tried that with me before. It's a classic tactic. But then the person released the real video where they all jump in and answer with great answers. So see, this is getting behind the curtain, and this is what we do. We destroy them. Brian Williams, Glenn Beck, Katie Couric. We take them one person, Mr. Maddow, Mrs. Who's the one that wears the glasses? It's Mr. Maddow, and then it's Mrs.
Hayes.
Mrs. Hayes, yeah. I confuse them all. I don't have a teleprompter, folks. I get names wrong. Like earlier, saying Ken League, it's Tim League. But getting serious here, they know what they're doing. And the latest thing, he goes, it's ridiculous, despicable. Matt Drudge says that I threatened Donald Trump on my show. That's ridiculous. A few months ago, he said, I want to get up there on stage. If I was there, I'd stab him, and the stabbing wouldn't stop. And then Beck came out and said that he didn't mean that, and that it didn't say that, and that Drudge linking to it was wrong. Now he's done it again with this writer on there saying we need, you know, somebody to take action, a good patriot, if Congress won't stop Trump. But then they add, we're just saying that hypothetically. That's like if you're sitting around talking about murdering somebody, hypothetically, you know, how much would it cost to take out my husband? Or hypothetically, how much would it take to take out my wife? You know, I'm writing a novel. They sit there with provisos, which makes it even more premeditated, on a show with a few million listeners, used to be a lot, trying to get some nut to do something. This is so crazy. And then denying it and saying Matt Drudge is a liar. Let's go to one of the clips now. We'll come back with more. Here he is a few months ago saying stab Donald Trump.
If I were on the stage, I would have said, have you been listening to him tonight? Right.
Yeah.
Right. Have you been listening to what I say about him?
And also, why would
you I believe these things. Yeah,
sit in their shoes. I mean, was he have gigantic shoes? How could you be sitting in
them? If I were close enough and I had a knife. Really, I mean,
what?
The stabbing just wouldn't stop.
Okay, Brandon, it's a long clip before that. They're talking about Trump the whole time. They carefully don't say his name right before, but say big shoes, meaning small hands. But they're talking about Trump. They've done it again. And then they go, how dare you, scumbag? He calls him evil.
Visit GCNlive.com.
Beck calls him evil. Others call him a scumbag. His other little men. This just in from WorldNet Daily. Dr. Carsey, feds suppressing draft criminal indictment against Hillary. This after the State Department's own inspector general found significant security risk and that Hillary Clinton lied repeatedly. Ron Paul's coming up to be discussing this and a lot more here in a moment. But look, Let's play that clip one more time where they're talking about Donald Trump and the whole debate. And they were on the stage with him. He would stab him and keep stabbing him. It's clearly who he's talking about. The New York Times has had people call for him to be killed. They leave stuff up on Twitter and Facebook saying, kill him, kill Trump. But now none of that exists. And now he's had this writer on where they discussed killing him and said, you know, a good patriot needs to stand up and do this. And when they come out and Drudge links to an article about it, they say Drudge is evil and Drudge is a horrible person and a piece of garbage, close quote, because he even linked to a news article about it. Beck calls Drudge evil for suggesting he advocated a patriot killed Donald Trump. Co-host labels news icon despicable lying scumbag. Glenn Beck sensationally labeled Matt Drudge evil for linking to a post that suggested Beck and his guest on his radio show advocated a patriot assassinate Donald Trump if he becomes president. The American Mirror characterized Beck's discussion with best-selling author Brad Thor as an agreement between the two that they would only way to get Trump out of office was to apparently kill him. And you can tell they're scripting it as to not get in trouble with the Secret Service. Then they say, let's just hypothetically, in a literary way, you know, talk about this. You know, we need, if Congress won't stop him, then we need somebody else to, you know, a patriot. This is really creepy, folks. So let's play Beck one more time from a few months ago at CPAC, and then let's play the latest one. And each time he denies that's even what he's saying. Here it is.
If I were on the stage, I would have said, have you been listening to him tonight?
Right. Yeah. Right.
Have you been listening to what I say about him?
And also, why would
no,
you
I actually, sitting I believe these shoes. Things. Yeah, I'm
yeah.
You not going to be.
Would
you
be
can't
weird.
Sit in their shoes. I mean, was he have gigantic shoes? How could you be
oh,
sitting
man,
in
if I were close enough and I had a knife. Really, I mean.
Wait, what?
The stabbing just wouldn't stop.
Okay, it's in full context on Infowars.com. They're talking about Trump and how everybody should be against him and never Trump, and then they segue, but for time I'm just showing the clip where he talks about stabbing him. Now this audio is really not that great because I guess it is the Glenn Beck show, but Richard Reeves is on the road covering politics and he was listening to it, following it, and monitoring enemy transmissions, and actually caught video of this audio for you. The full in context is up on Infowars.com, but here's a shorter clip of it.
Well, we have talked about it before. We have seen it time and time again, but it's getting worse. Here's Jake Tapper on the latest National Enquirer angle.
Once again, journalists are in the unhappy predicament of trying to decide whether and how to cover false allegations raised by a candidate for president of the United States. This time, in the midst of Donald Trump's attacks on the Clintons using various scandals and accusations of Bill and Hillary Clinton's until his tragic suicide. In July 1993, Foster, who suffered from depression, drove to Fort Marcy Park in Virginia, walked into the park with an old
Okay, we're going to fade this down because of the time constraints, but you can see the full video. Then he says what a great job he's doing. Here's the Thor comment with Beck, talking about we need a patriot to step forward if Congress won't deal with Trump. Here it is.
With the feckless, spineless Congress we have, who will stand in the way of Donald Trump overstepping his constitutional authority as president? If Congress won't remove him from office, what patriot will step up and do that? If he oversteps his mandate as president, his constitutional granted authority, I should say, as president, if he oversteps that, how will we get him out of office? And I don't think there is a legal means available. I think it will be a terrible, terrible position the American people will be in to get Trump out of office, because you won't be able to do it through Congress.
Well, I would agree with you on that.
So, again, they're the ones that started the fights with Matt Drudge and everybody. They're the people that are going after Trump. They're the people going after populism. He's the guy that goes and gives, you know, teddy bears to the illegals and all the rest of it. Will he give teddy bears to the troops that are being euthanized? I mean, it's all stunts. We live in an incredible time, to say the least. We are seeing so many good things happen, but also so many bad things. We're seeing the Associated Press come out with a national poll a month ago showing that 6% of news consumers trust mainstream media. We're seeing the ratings go from bad to worse at CNN and MSNBC and so many other platforms. Fox, to even stay pertinent, has to be Ron Paul / Alex Jones light. And, of course, Ron Paul's launched in the last few years his own radio TV network, now reaching tens of millions a month. We're doing the same thing. Competition is absolutely beautiful for a free market and an open society. That's why John D. Rockefeller called it a sin, famously. So I want to talk about these moves by the Federal Elections Commission deputy chair to try to censor the internet, starting with Matt Drudge, and then talk radio, starting with Rush Limbaugh. Because if they can take down Matt Drudge or Rush Limbaugh, folks, they can take down anybody's free speech. And believe me, they have been eyeing Campaign for Liberty. They've been eyeing InfoWars. They've been eyeing Ron Paul's private media operations because they're so effective. So I wanted to speak with the former congressman and medical doctor and really the torchbearer worldwide for libertarian ideas, in my view, I think that's undisputed, about where he sees the world right now and what the establishment's going to do. Also, the big central banks are moving to try to abolish cash. He, for decades, tried to get the bill passed. It's very close to passing, finally, after not even having any co-sponsors a few decades ago, to audit the Fed. It seems liberty's on the march, but also tyranny's on the rise. The best of times, worst of times. And we'll talk about Campaign 2016 and more. Dr. Paul, thank you so much for spending time with us. You look great. It's good to have you with us via your Skype connection.
Thank you, Alex. Good to see you today.
We've got about a 2 or 3 second delay, so I'll try to just not jump in too much, just with a few questions. You heard what I threw out. Where would you like to start? With the moves to censor? I don't think I've ever seen, with Facebook and all the rest of them being caught, censorship of this magnitude.
I think we live in an age where there's no understanding and no respect whatsoever for personal liberty and personal privacy. The founders understood it much better. They tried to protect us against a big government that would come in and destroy that. But there is a collusion between big business, corporatism, and big government that are in control, so therefore they can control the output. It used to be that newspapers did it in three major networks, and we understood it. And then it changed when there were more cable stations and internet stations and all. But they haven't quit. They're still challenging us. And you're right, the IRS has not been kind to us. They've been after us quite a few different times on some of our organizations, and they continue to do it. They'd like to bankrupt us, through all the money you have to spend to try to defend oneself. But I think what we're witnessing today is a result of an era ending. And I've talked about this for maybe 5+ years, about the end of an era. Because I believe the era of big government, the progressive era, really exhausted itself probably at the end of the last century. And now we have just been fidgeting and trying to keep things together. And that's why, the political parties are in shambles, the economy's in shambles, civil liberties are in shambles. But the real problem is that the system we have today isn't working, it's ending. Keynesian economics doesn't work, that model is bad. And never worked, but that was the substitute for fascism and communism. And the 20th century did a pretty good job at smashing it, because it's a total failure. And there are still some who would like to be socialists and think that Venezuela is the way to go and all this nonsense. But, the markets are very powerful. The market said that fascism and communism failed. But the substitute, the American substitute of Keynesianism, economic planning, central banking, inflationism, fiat money, and running our lives, regulating our lives, taking away our liberties, and also this obsession with us believing that we are so exceptional that we can tell the rest of the world how to live, and we should be exceptional in dealing with our own problems and setting a good example. But so I think the mess that we're in today is the end of this era, and without anybody admitting this, we and those in the freedom movement have been trying to warn people of this and giving them an option. And quite frankly, I think we're doing fine there, even though, like you mentioned, Alex, on the introduction, that statism and big government's alive and well. But they're bankrupt, so they will end, just as our empire will end. Keynesian economics will fail. The central banking system is going to fail. We just have to concentrate on it to energize another generation, that there is an option for this, there is an alternative, and of course, that's what I've been working on for quite a few years.
Absolutely, Dr. Paul. Expanding on that, looking at what the so-called left is doing, allied with the establishment Republicans in this country, similarly in Europe, where I know you've traveled and spoken extensively as well, they now, because they were discredited last century, as you said, are instead just trying to dumb everyone down and really much overthrow reality and overthrow the engines of free market that are left, because they just can't compete with that even existing. Even though it brings down the civilization, they'd rather rural people, you know, not be able to take care of themselves. They'd rather city people not be able to take care of themselves. They'd rather the whole country and the whole world be poor and rule a huge junk pile instead of a great civilization. And so my concerns are, what do you see them doing in their death throes? Because even most mainline analysts are starting to agree with you that we're coming to the end of a bubble, that no matter what the establishment does, they're not going to be able to suppress change. More and more young people are waking up. So clearly, I agree with you, this great turning that you've talked about for decades, but you've said is very close for 5 years, is pretty much here. But how do you expect the empire to strike back? I mean, I think we're seeing it. Open, naked authoritarianism. But doesn't that only accelerate the fall of their system?
Well, yes, they're a failure, but they will strike out. And I think that what they have going for them right now is the dumbing down of America. So in many ways, they have been successful by getting hold of the public school system and teaching people, you know, bad economics and bad foreign policy and all the things that are wrong. But at the same time, you know, the failure is there. I think they know that the failure is there, but they will strike out and they will become more authoritarian. And I think that is exactly what they're doing. And it isn't a partisan thing when you know that the Nancy Pelosi's of the world and the John Boehner's of the world were much more buddies than anybody realized, but that continues. The parties mean very little. But I think if nothing else, this current election cycle that's going on represents the dumbing down of America. But then again, does that mean we should be exhausted and run for the hills, or should we continue the fight? Obviously, I'm here for the fight, and to me, it's an intellectual fight, and we have to beat them with better ideas. And I think there is a receptive audience out there. But what they have power because they're in control right now. But what we have on our side is that ideas have consequences. You can't stop ideas. Even the armies and the governments can't stop ideas if their time has come. And of course, the need has come. And certainly we hope to make it, our time has come for the option to be, because I see the collapsing of this system as the opportunity to be more forceful in our presentation, because they will be very aggressive. They will use the judicial system and the IRS and everything else, because their goal is power. They believe that they are exceptional. They believe that they know what is best for us. For instance, the silliness of what this country has endorsed now with the Federal Reserve, that they know what interest rates should be. That's the most ridiculous thing in the world for somebody who knows anything about economics in a free market. So I think there's, in the midst of this mess, we do have opportunities.
Sir, you've got so many organizations and groups and TV shows and radio shows. I see it and hear it everywhere. I want to say congratulations to your media team. It's so wonderful to see you, not just in Congress now, but you look younger than you did 5 years ago, so congratulations on you know, the hard fight in Congress and not missing any votes that you couldn't, and working so hard and now reaching so many people. But is Ron Paul, LibertyReport.com, is that one of the best sites to talk about?
Yeah, we concentrate on that, although we, you know, we have a homeschool curriculum and Campaign for Liberty and other sites. But yes, this is my outlet. This is my effort to reach more people, the Ron Paul LibertyReport.com. And our growth is very significant, and I'm excited about it, but we still have a ways to go. But
absolutely,
if you look at what are the various organizations, if you look at the line of growth, it's in the Liberty Report, and that's where I put a lot of my efforts right now.
RonPaulLibertyReport.com, folks, absolutely key to get those articles and videos out to everybody. Now, speaking of this, you, of course, are a retired gynecologist, and you also delivered babies. I guess that's an obstetrician. Correct me if I'm wrong, sir. And I know that you even, you know, famously, without trying to get attention, but it's well known, would go and work basically for free in the charity hospitals. I mean, you're a real Hippocratic Oath type doctor, and so many people that you delivered and so many families that you helped, you know, have spoken out in your campaigns about the great job you've done, a true servant. I know you don't like folks to heap praise on you, but you are uniquely positioned to speak about Obamacare and also about things happening with men and women's issues. So just briefly, the Alamo Draft House, as you know, is a Texas chain based here in Austin, Texas. I know the owner of it, the founder of it. They have been convinced, it's in KXAN, at their new theaters to just have one giant bathroom where men and women both use urinals. That's in KXAN, NBC. I'm not kidding. And I've got the State Department and CIA reports. We've done articles back from 30 years ago about how they wanted to merge men and women together to basically break down the family. And I have another article here out of National Review where they came out and said, we need to get rid of the family. You shouldn't read to your children at night. That, you know, that advances them too much. I know this all sounds crazy, but we're putting it on screen, folks. This is meant to create division, hysteria, insanity, infighting, in my view. And the article actually has the owner saying, we want to do this. Let me read the quote, then I'll go back to you, sir. But I wanted to give you this info so you could respond to it. He said, this design will hopefully eliminate conflict. So let me ask you, Dr. Paul, as a doctor, what do you think all this transgender stuff's about? I mean, I know you're not a hater. I'm not a hater. We're libertarians. These aren't our issues. But what is this? Because this is all they talk about. It's all that seems to be going on. And now they say if it goes well at this new theater, they're going to do it at the theaters I go to with my family. I cannot go with my daughters and lead them into a bathroom with women, I'm sorry, squatting over urinals. What is this, sir? This sounds like mental illness to me, doctor.
Right, and they're determined, and this is social turmoil. But it's come about because we've lost the sense of private property, because the property owner should make all these decisions. But this is something that is absolutely absurd. But you know, if they win with this presentation, and the people go along with it because they have been coerced and bribed into it, the principle is the government gives you money. And then all the states and local communities grab the money. So in education, different things, schools, they take the money. And the reason why they go along with the law is if you don't do exactly what we tell you, you know, they did this with speed limits and everything else. They put out the carrot there and they say, we're going to take it away from you unless you go along with it. So then the politicians go along with it and the people get frightened. Oh, it's going to cost a lot more. Liberty doesn't mean anything at all. So this is the real problem that we have. But if they win and we don't wake up enough people and there's not enough fighting back on legal terms at the same time using boycotts, they shouldn't get blamed for this. We, the people, have to get blamed for this because we go along with this and we have indoctrinated our own people to say, oh, this is the right thing to do. This is good. And if you don't go along with it, you're a bigot. Well, maybe if you don't go along with it, you believe in private property. We don't grant people these rights because in our house, to come in and use our house and live there and use the bathroom. So we write all the rules. But a business is private property. Do they get to write their own rules? No, we gave up on that a long time ago because they said we'd be bigots if we got to write our own rules. So this is the whole problem. The answers can be found in private property and voluntarism and cooperation with two people, no matter whether it's a social or economic issue.
But your expert view concurs basically with what I said, that this is just turmoil, Cloward and Piven, divide and conquer. If they can't compete with free market, just create a whole bunch of crazy confusion. Because, I mean, in a lot of their own writings, they admit that's their plan.
Yeah, I think that if you look at the surface, that looks like they're doing quite well. But what we have to have is people to understand that a moral principle can be used to combat what they're saying, because they want to grab the moral high ground. You know, we become the bigots if we even challenge anything they say. They're supposed to be able to set the standard. And of course, for a libertarian, the standard is set no aggression against anybody else. And it's your life, your body, and your property, and you can do with it what you want as long as you don't hurt other people. But see, that's been rejected, but that is what should be emphasized over and above everything else, rather than entitlements and corporatism and the financial system we have and the international governments that are developing. They have to be challenged. Through an intellectual challenge by ideas. It can't be challenged with a little bit of token political activity. That's important, but ultimately it's the ideas that count.
Again, former Congressman Ron Paul is our guest, Ron Paul, LibertyReport.com. In closing, sir, I want to, in a few minutes, spend some time getting into your brainchild, auditing the Federal Reserve. In 102 years, it hasn't been audited. I guess it's about time now. But before we go there, briefly, so many people contact me, so many listeners, so many people on the street, folks connected to the whole Donald Trump campaign, you name it, and they say, look, we know Donald Trump isn't perfect. I disagree with him on his Apple spying stuff and on torture, but he doesn't want war with Russia, and he doesn't, you know, want war in Syria. He does a lot of good things. But separately, just that he's a populist at some level, just that he's going after political correctness, that he wants to audit the Fed, that he admires you. I know he said some mean things about Rand, but Rand said some things back to him. I would love to see both men friends. I know they played golf. But all that aside, is there any way that you could be given, say, a list of his policies that are on his site and say, I don't fully endorse Trump, you know, like Senator Sessions and others do, but, and Sessions said he's not perfect, but the system hates him. He's a populist. He wants better deals for us. He's an anti-globalist. The CFR hates him. I mean, it would just be so wonderful to see a purist, you know, Dr. No, a guy with a perfect constitutional record like yourself. I understand you don't want to now endorse him because you've got a perfect record, something nobody else has. But is there any way to at least highlight the things you think are good? Because I would love to see, you know, the whole Ron Paul libertarian revolution somehow, you know, at least talking to the Trump populist movement.
Well, I think he's too much all over the place. What he says one day is something, the next day sometimes he flip-flops in one day in what he has said over the years. So I have no idea what he believes in. I don't believe he has a basic principle, a basic libertarian principle. Sure, the one thing that he does real well is challenges this political correctness. So no matter what your beliefs are, people get sick and tired of political correctness, and that's very good. But his economic policies are all over the place. When you talk about a 35% tax on imports, you're looking for a trade war. Trade wars lead to bad wars. So no, I think personally he's very much of an authoritarian. I'm not looking for a boss. I'm looking for somebody who will leave me alone, and he hasn't convinced me that he'll leave me alone. I think he will be the champion of the executive order because he has lived with executive orders, and if he has the strings of power, he won't be bashful in using that. So that is why I'm very hesitant.
Well, I understand, and I've had problems as well. I mean, what he said is basically that's the negotiation with China is a huge threat. Because they basically have a 35%, you know, obvious a tariff internally on us with their currency and some of the things they do. And then there would be a negotiation. But I can see if people take the brashness that he is kind of being the man on the white horse. Let me ask you this then, and then briefly about the Federal Reserve audit, Bill. Why do you think the establishment on both sides is so scared of Trump?
Because it reveals how the deep state works. It reveals exactly what goes on behind the scenes. And the most important part of their secrecy is the interconnection of all the central banks and the arrangements that we make, especially during the bailout period, 08 and 09. That is the part that they keep very secret. But over the years, even all the way back to Wright-Patman days and Gonzalez's day, the populist-type Democrats, they were always stopped because they did not want to reveal what goes on internationally. And that ties this globalism together, because if you control the money, you can control the politics of it. So that is the most important thing. It would reveal the individuals, the political interests that benefit. So there are financial interests, the bankers' interests, but there's foreign governments and foreign central banks and corporations. They all benefit, and they don't want
that revealed. Sure. Do you think they're against Trump because he supports your audit
of the
Fed bill?
The audit is very, very important.
Sure. How do we get your audit the Fed bill passed? I know it's very, very close.
Who's against it?
Well, I was saying, I mean, that may be one reason they're against it.
Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea whether that's important. I don't think it's known to be an issue in this campaign. If you go out and talk to a couple thousand
people
involved
in Sanders' campaign. Sure, I understand. Let's briefly then in 60 seconds talk about audit the Fed. Auditing the Fed, we're very close to getting your dream done, correct?
Well, audit the Fed is doing, well, we're getting a long way on it, but a Campaign for Liberty, our other group, works on that constantly. We've had several votes because we stirred up the population and they told their congressman, we want you to vote for audit the Fed. It's been very, very successful because we always win the votes overwhelmingly in the House. In the Senate, it's a different story. Rand's gotten a vote once in the Senate. He got a majority vote, but they closed it by closure. So we haven't passed in the Senate. We have a long way to go. And right now, I don't think that any Republican or Democrat that's been running even in this past year, other than Rand, would actually allow the audit to occur. Because, you know, there's too much tied in. Trump Trump doesn't think the interest rate should ever raise. He loves the idea that the Fed has interest rates down to 0% because his business deals depend on that. So anyway, I don't think we're on the verge of passing it, but we're on the verge of getting a lot more attention. And when this thing comes apart, the Fed has to be the big issue. That's how all this globalism and big government has been financed, and that is through the monetary system.
Amazing, doctor.
That, of course, I think is one of the places where we've had amazing that much success.
Congratulations, 30 years positioning it so the guys that hijack the country get the blame when it comes down, and we're almost there. Thank you so much for your time. RonPaulLibertyReport.com. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, Alex.
All right, he did a pretty good job with a three-second delay. All right, folks, we'll be back. Stay with us. That was Dr. Ron Paul. I'm going to be honest with everybody. I get angry on air, and it's real when I get angry, but it's kind of like letting the dog off the leash. So you could say it's fake in that I'm allowing myself to do it. But that's kind of like saying, you know, if you have sex with a woman, you know, it's fake because you let yourself do it. I mean, it's not fake. Or it's like if you let yourself go swim in the ocean, it's not fake. But when I blow up, when I start yelling and screaming, I'm allowing myself to do it, and it is a way of venting, but it's real. Not earlier today. I got so flipped out, not even that angry on air, but physically angry that I want to leave right now, but I'm not going to do it. I'm going to breathe, and I'm going to settle down, and everything's going to get okay. Because when something hits you at home, like a month ago, I went down to Barton Creek Mall, where I've been going since I was in elementary school. I'd come down here and visit my grandparents on the summer. They take me to the mall. It's an old mall. I've lived here since high school. I've been going there every couple of weeks since high school. I go to the mall, and there's women wearing beekeeper suits everywhere. I mean, every turn. I start hyperventilating. And folks, I don't do this normally. I mean, I don't do this back when I was younger. When three guys were wanting to mug me, I didn't start hyperventilating. And I've got my daughters with me, and there's all these Middle Eastern men, and it's just culture shock that our government's bringing all these people in, and these women were basically slaves. I mean, they get killed, folks, if they try to take their beekeeper prisoner mask off. It's like at, you know, Gitmo, they put a hood over your head. That kind of freaked me out. But then Leanne McAdoo comes in here with an Austin American Statesman report and a couple others. And a KXAN report, a TV report, and with a straight face, they start talking about we're going to get rid of men's and women's bathrooms and have communal bathrooms where men and women both use urinals. And they've got a big snout that sticks out, and the woman basically grabs it. And it's all about dehumanizing us. And they've got the owner of Alamo Drafthouse, who I've known for 18 years, saying this is to stop disturbances. You're going to have, I mean, I'm not taking my 8 and 11-year-old daughters and my 13-year-old son all in there. I mean, we don't go in the bathroom with each other now. It's been a long time since I went in bathrooms with my daughters. Because we like privacy, you freaks, and civilization. And I had a panic attack. I've never had panic attacks in my life, but I've been asking people. I may go to a psychologist. I'm not kidding. I mean, I'm starting to have panic attacks where I can't breathe. Okay, these people are coming after us. And by the way, Tim League knows full well what he's doing, okay? The owner of the Alamo Draft House. He knows full well. This is social engineering. And it's a sick joke. Now, I mean, the school, almost everyone, boys and girls, 13, 14, 15, up to high school, and then people I know that are 60 years old are watching Gavin McInnes and also the next host that's coming on with us. That's exciting when people hit the zeitgeist. But I'm like reading his bio and I go, oh, he's one of the founders of Vice. So, of course, he's a smart guy. And I guess they sold that for a few hundred million or whatever it was to HBO. Now they've kind of taken it a new direction. But whatever. The point is that this is the real media right here. And I'm not in competition with somebody like Gavin McInnes. I love the fact he's out there bringing up different points, different angles, some of the same points, because this is a war. I want to beat these people. I don't want to be like Glenn Beck, the guy that has all the answers and knows everything and tells people he's Moses on the mountain. I want an army to defeat these people. I want to hit them from every angle because it gets to me personally. He'll be with us 30 minutes to the next hour, and then Anthony Cumia will continue on for another 30 minutes. But the two will be on together in the next 30 minutes as well after this hour ends. But boy, it is just crazy the amount of news. They're saying they want to get rid of the grading system and get rid of below C minus. Now, they always propose that. They're doing it now. They are announcing that they want to get rid of parents reading to their children at night and because the family's bad. They're actually saying it on ABC News. I've got those articles. Gavin made a great point. He was on with Paul Watson last week. And I appreciate him joining us again this week. I had to take care of a family matter, and Paul sat in. He made a great point. He said they just want to blow up civilization because they can't compete with normal free market civilization. That's it. These people know what they're doing. And I want to ask Gavin a question. How high up, though? I mean, we know the top engineers know this. They write white papers on it in textbooks. This is admitted. They give ABC News interviews now. But how low down in the strata of the average trendy authoritarian mental patient cult member liberal do they realize this is about destroying civilization? Gavin, you've got CompoundMedia.com. Twitter is Gavin underscore McInnes, McInnes. We salute your wonderful work. You've got the Gavin McInnes Show that is on Eastern Time many days right up against us at the same time, which I think is just wonderful because I could care less. It's attack on all fronts. Thanks for popping in with us today, Gavin. What is going on here?
Well, here's the big question is, how much of this sabotage has an agenda? Like, what are they trying to do? And, of course, there's the theory that it's all about destroying civilization, destroying Western cultures so they can rebuild something new. But I'm starting to think that what's really going on here is just sabotage. Like, I think George Soros's father was on his deathbed. And he just said to George, just go make a huge mess. And then he died, and George went, all right, I'm just going to throw money at sabotage. I don't think there's an agenda here. I think it's just malicious. It's just malicious discontent.
I agree with you. They set up a system to rot the sub-mass to make us servile idiots, but it's affecting them in blowback. And now the program has gotten out like zombies out of the underground base, and it's just wreaking havoc where the most radical, stupid ones are now commanders as they have taxpayer-funded systems dumping Drano in their eyes and having taxpayers pay for them and their arms and legs chopped off to live in little boxes. And folks, if you're a new viewer, this is the new trendy stuff to do. I mean, how far will it go, Gavin?
Well, it will go until we discipline them. It's almost like a crazy girlfriend that wants to get slapped. And I've noticed when I'm in my community, which is Hipstersville, Brooklyn, I live in Williamsburg, and when I wear my Trump shirt, I've noticed there's this strange sort of capitulation where they sort of bow their heads and accept that I am the alpha in this situation. So I think that these far-left nut bars that are sabotaging our culture don't really want to sabotage it. It's like a child acting out. And you know,
they're betas that want to be put in their place.
They want a timeout. And it's our job to do that. And that's what we're doing with Compound Media. That's what you're doing in InfoWars. We're saying, I know you want to get slapped. Here's a slap.
Sometimes a girl needs a good smack. Which I don't actually believe in that, but that's a famous quote from Sean Connery. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, they really honestly don't want to take over. And look at what they do, too. They say, okay, I don't like the patriarchy. I don't like white males. I don't like cis, whatever we're called this week. And they go, and you go, all right, because guys are pretty, us cis white males are pretty open-minded. We go, all right, well, what do you got? Maybe I do suck. And they go, it's called Sharia law. And you go, that's what you're going to replace me with? Something that was me 500 years ago, the Salem witch trials, we're going back to that? No, we're not doing that. That's what's crazy here is they don't have a plan B. They want to eradicate Western tradition. They want to blow up conservatism. They want to destroy the family, the patriarchy, marriage, all that stuff. And you go, wow, you must have a great plan if you're sabotaging.
They're like, no, we'll replace it with caveman patriarchy with a bunch of inbred psychopaths cutting women's genitals off and putting beekeeper outfits on them and all murdering each other. Why is the left so in love with radical jihadists?
Because they feel guilty that they haven't done anything with their lives, and it makes them feel bad about themselves. And who makes you feel bad about yourself? Your dad. So all my anger is now going to be directed towards daddy. Everyone who looks like dad is evil, and I'm going to discredit dad so I don't feel bad that I took mass comm at NYU and put myself $60,000 in debt.
Exactly. They've got worthless educations, and now they've weaponized it to make people so mentally ill and so confused and you know, obsessed with brown paper bags or that somebody's having a costume party that they don't realize they've been totally screwed over.
Exactly. The lunatics want to run the asylum, but we're telling them, trust me, if I let you run the asylum, you're all going to die. Piggy's going to get the conch shell like in Lord of the Flies, and he's going to get brained with a big rock. Trust me, you're better off with me in charge because I've been doing this for a quarter of a million years.
That is what's crazy, though. Where they're leading us is Road Warrior with, like, literal warlords driving around in armored vehicles with heads mounted on the front, with women in bikinis and chains, with Slayer playing. I mean, that's where this goes in like 10 years if they keep going this direction.
It is. And the fact that Bernie Sanders is so popular, do you know what socialists do to gays? Do you know what these totalitarians do to creative types, to artists, to comedians? You know, you'll be the first to go, they like me. Islamists like Islamophobes like me because we have balls, we're alphas. The first to go is the gays and the artists and you, not you, Alex Jones, but you, the guy who is pro-Islam. I mean, we just had Eagles of Death Metal. They were...
Oh, yeah, let's talk about that.
89 people killed at that concert, right? The guy, the singer of the band, he says to me that he's suspicious of the security, he's suspicious of Islam, he's suspicious of Arabs, Arab money, and now he's backtracking because it's killing his band. They're having shows canceled because they dared to question the narrative. And what's fantastic about it is, in the interview, he said to me, you ever read George Orwell? You ever read Animal Farm? He goes, as soon as someone questions the narrative, they all become bleeding sheep. And then, after saying that, exactly what he said happens. The bleeding sheep start canceling their shows. And now Jesse Hughes is a pariah. He's actually mad at me. We're not friends anymore because I got him in this mess. And I go, don't get mad at me. Get mad at the mess.
They're the ones going after your free speech. Oh, we're so sorry that radical jihadis came and shot everybody and was, you know, all this garbage. No, no, no. Now that he didn't, that everybody didn't grovel properly, he's got to have his shows canceled.
A woman stepped in front of him. She got shot in the face. Her jaw exploded. She's dead. He had shrapnel of teeth and bone in his face. He had to get stitches. They had to pull teeth out of his face. And we are sitting here telling him that we, quote unquote, disagree. That's what the promoter said, who canceled their show at Rock on Sin, which is like the Coachella.
He's the victim. The West is the victim. The free speech is the victim. And it's the West that empowered women and opened everything up. I mean, I can put it on screen. BBC, Communist China kills gay men. All these countries kill them, but then we're supposed to sit here and then let pedophiles have access to our kids or we're homophobic.
Well, you know what's really going on here is the socialists, the communists, the far left, when they notice a pattern, they commit genocide. So that's why they're so petrified of noticing a pattern of any sort of discussion of eugenics or biology or any kind of pattern, because they've noticed their boy Stalin, their boy Pol Pot, their boy Hitler. They tend to exterminate the people that notice a pattern. Us here on the right with the libertarians, we go, we notice a pattern, we just discuss it. We don't kill anyone. That's what's crazy about the left and the right. We all have our opinions, but the left enforces their opinions to a fault. The right just sits there going, I've noticed a pattern here. That's interesting. And they let meritocracy take over. If you're tall and you're good at basketball, you're in the NBA. The end.
Well, that's right. In fact, they're now, I'm sure you saw the National Review article, I mentioned it, where they're talking to this professor on ABC News like it's normal, going, well, it's very bad to read to your kids because other people don't read to their kids. And it's bad to have private school. And, you know, families actually say, family's something we're not going to get rid of quite yet, but, you know, the state will allow it for now, but we're phasing it out with a straight face. Well, then it's wrong then if you're a 7-foot-tall black guy named LeBron James because, you know, the Lollipop Guild can't beat you at basketball.
It's just a war on – it's funny, you know, info wars. What do we want? We want information. We just want an open discourse. They want to shut down discourse, and I think it's based on revenge. It's based on spite. And there's the Indian Child Welfare Act. I had this Lauren McGill on my show the other day, and – this six-year-old girl, Lexi Page, she's 1.4% Choctaw, and she was ripped from her foster family, her white foster family, at 6 years old, torn from them and thrown to some other family who's loosely related to Choctaws through marriage. And the Indian Child Welfare Act ruined this family. I mean, destroyed her siblings. This poor girl's siblings are having seizures because they're so traumatized by this event. And why are we doing it? It's not to make to reunite an Indian family. It's not to right any wrongs. It's just pure revenge. And this spiteful, horrible act is taking white guilt and punishing this family because of what we did in the past. Yes, it was terrible what we did with the Indians. We separated families. That was terrible. But to create legislation that is just pure revenge, it's sick and twisted. And you know who suffers? Lexi Page.
Exactly. It's all about social engineering. Gavin McInnes is our guest, radio TV host. One of the founders of Vice Media. We're going to break. I want to come back and get into some of the angles and issues that you're looking at front and center. But just briefly, is it a sign of weakness in the authoritarian left and this orgy of control that Facebook's openly censoring, denies it, is forced to admit it, that the Federal Elections Commission wants to regulate drugs, that means us next? I mean, really, this is so naked. I'm surprised more on the so-called left aren't repenting and defending the First Amendment. Because you could say what you wanted about the left a long time ago. I'm a libertarian. More allied with them on many cases. But no, they're just like, no, get rid of free speech. We're taking over. That's really scary.
Yes. Well, what we have here is a zenith. We've reached full peak SJW, and this is not their year. You know that zombie song? This will be our year. Took a long time to come. This is our year. And people always ask me, well, where do you get that from? And if you're not watching it every day, you don't really see what is happening with the culture. But right now, these idiots have gone too far. And a great example I always use is the chalkening. Someone wrote Trump in chalk on a university floor, on the ground. Everyone went ballistic. Instead of getting sympathy, more Trump 2016 happened. And Trump and this sort of chalkening, they call it, is a perfect example of how they are done and it's our turn.
That's right. The minute we start resisting and don't follow their orders is the minute they start to fall. And their orders get so bizarre, so extreme, so insane that we're forced to say, okay, I'm not going to the Alamo Draft House for women to use a urinal. It's over, weirdos. We'll be right back. By the way, I am the opposite of trendy. Okay, let's just get that out there, that I pay no attention. But most people who are really trendy and cause the trends don't pay attention. And of course, I'm now learning more about Gavin McInnes since I've been watching for 6 months. And obviously has a big buzz going. He's had big buzzes before, started Vice. That I was reading here, he's known as the godfather of hipsterdom. And then left Vice in 2007, I guess, because they were not truly hip anymore. And that's my deal. He looks just like the Russian czar, the one that looked like the British king, back in, World War One. I mean, he could be a body double. I guess he was born in England. But look, he looks good with that beard and that mustache. He pulls it off. He's the guy that started it. In fact, I was just Googling. I didn't know that. But now everybody's got the beard. And my only issue is, if you can't pull it off, don't do it. But there's Gavin McInnes. Nicholas II, Tsar of Russia. I'm sure that's not the first time you've been told this. Hey, I got to go to him in a moment because I got to plug at least once this hour. I already skipped a break with Ron Paul. Buy our products. They'll blow you away. The best water filters, the best non-GMO seeds, the best game-changing nutraceuticals. This hippopotamus lost 70 pounds on X2 and Supermel Vitality. Supermel Vitality is back in stock, 2 months sold out because it's hard to get the herbs and cold press them and just keep them in stock. And we're not changing the formula, but it's a big problem. It's sold out 6 months out of the year. It's sold out a few months and we get more. We're trying to up the production, but it is that good. It's kind of like certain vintage wines or certain years, you just run out. And it's like wine. It blows people away. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. Free shipping on orders, $50 or more. $10 off or 10% off when you sign up for auto ship. So InfoWarsLife.com, thanks for supporting the broadcast. Okay, Gavin, I just made the whole point about that you secretly are related to Tsar Nicholas II.
That's actually a secret. You shouldn't have mentioned that on the show. Lord designed a man's face to cover the fact that you don't have a chin and you have aesthetic problems. I don't know why we ignore that. I look at Rupert Murdoch, and as Carl Pilkington says, he looks like a turtle without his shell. If you're ugly.
Well, hey, here's the deal. I have not a weak chin. It's actually, my dad's a dentist, about as big as they get. It's like a bulldog, so it's giant. So I have a regular length chin, but you're right. It looks like I have a small chin because I have a giant pumpkin head. But if I grow a beard, I look like a caveman. You think I should grow one now that it's like now uncool? Or what should I do?
By all means. What is, you've got kind of a round head. Are you a Slovak? Are you Eastern European?
No, but if you mix like a Brit with a German and then Native American, that's pretty much what Slovaks are, because that's where the Indians came from, was basically China, Huns, over the Bering Strait of the Americas. So I'm kind of like an artificial Western genetic variety of a Slav, actually.
You're a homemade Slav.
I'm an American-made Slav with no original Slav, but even older Slav from Bering Land Strait, 15,000-year-old Asian.
Yes. Well, I married an Indian, and I made a bunch of Indians. They're very cute as kids. I highly recommend them.
All right, listen, I'm running over you here. You got censored famously or manipulated, and I want to talk about this some in the next hour with you, but let's start talking about it now. On The Daily Show, there's a new case of Katie Couric caught. I don't know if you've seen this. Just came out yesterday where she edited the video to make it look like they couldn't answer a question, but they could.
Okay, so here's the assumption, right? White male patriarchy is retarded. We're idiots. And we're so stupid, by the way, that when we talk and when we express our beliefs, the left sort of goes, oh, God, here we go again with this idiotic mentality. This is so boring. And in order to purport that myth, they have to take dozens of people doing hours of research. They have to spend all this time in the editing lab, and they have to edit in pictures of them going, oh, which is what happened on The Daily Show. I did this interview with this guy about women's soccer, and his contention was that women are getting paid less for the same amount of work, which is just ridiculous. Women are not as good at soccer. There's more eyeballs for men's soccer. Yes, ladies, you had a good year in 2015. But
hold on, Gavin. Back in 70 seconds. A lot of breaks at the end of the hour. I'm going to come back, finish this. You caught him red-handed.
That's right.
Because they're such geniuses. The left's always, oh, we're such geniuses. Libertarians are so dumb. And they're the dumbest people. They're minions. Look at the Mark Dice videos. They can't even wipe their rear. All right, we're on a radio format, so a lot of our ads are at the end of an hour. I'm sorry, now we're going to break in 5 minutes, come back with a 12-minute segment, and we're going to have Anthony Cumia with the balance of the next hour with us. But part of that is going to be, I guess, having both hosts on together. And again, the website is compoundmedia.com. Gavin McInnes, who I just think is awesome. I really, really enjoy his humor. It's a little racy for the AM and FM crowd, so warning there, some parental concerns. It's adult information. But that's what it takes to also reach out to the trendies and the liberals and kind of deprogram them. But you got cut off by the break, Gavin. You were getting on The Daily Show, taking jokes you made and acting like they were serious and editing it together.
Exactly. So what they did after the interview, they recorded a bunch of reactions. So the guy, I forget, he has some stupid Indian name, but he's sitting there and they record him going, ugh, and ugh. And then they edit that in later. And at one point they said to me, name some soccer players. I don't know about American soccer. So I made up a bunch of names, and then I go, and then, of course, everyone's favorite, a guy who's known to most as Junebug. And then I made it clear to them that that was a joke, and they didn't know it was a joke. The guy said, oh, those are some deep cuts. And I go, those weren't deep cuts. I just made up those names. It was a joke. And then they made that the whole crux of their point was that I wanted to convince you that Junebug was a soccer player. But the big picture here is it takes so many resources and so much framing to make us look bad that they end up proving the opposite of what they're setting out to prove. They ended up proving that we're right and they're wrong.
That's right. Well, number one, 9/11 truth. They would always misrepresent what I was saying. I said criminal elements of our government are working with radical Islam. Bare minimum allowed this to happen. I had all these FBI agents and whistleblowers on. It was a fact. It's all coming out now. But Discovery Channel did this hour-long documentary that was 2 hours long. They've aired it probably 100 times. It's on all the time. It was like 7 years ago. And I talked to a packed crowd at UT, like 500 people. Okay, but I've had crowds with 5,000 before. But the point was, they cut at lunch to two or three people sitting there eating sandwiches in the, you know, big room and showed me speaking, cutting back and forth like there were five people. I mean, this is real deception.
If we are so stupid, then why can't you ridicule us? If you believe that Jews are lizard people, then that's easy to mock. I could just show you, you know, a surgeon working on a guy. We can see he doesn't have scales underneath. Very easy to mock. But if we are so easy to mock, why do you have to keep framing us? We just had this with Katie Couric, where we see the whole video and we learn that when she's said, why don't you have background checks? The people she was asking didn't sit there dumbfounded. No, they edited that in later.
What's crazy is they keep doing it even though they've been caught and their ratings are going down. Are they on a suicide mission? What's happening?
They're lazy. They haven't been challenged enough. That's the funny thing about being right. I mean, if you're a black conservative, you are getting hammered every Thanksgiving, every Christmas, every time you visit your nephews and nieces. And what that does is it's like training, and you end up getting better at drawing conclusions from data. And conservatives, anyone right of center, is so used to being challenged and questioned that we actually have become pretty good at the truth. Whereas the left has been so spoiled with their idiotic, infantilized view of the world, with the racist, evil, bad white man ruining everything, that when they get challenged, they get verklempt. They don't know what to do.
You're right. They really are spoiled, and they just lay back and act like they're intellectual giants. Look at Trigglypuff. Look at Age Skrillex. These are not even the worst examples. This is what we're talking about. Victims of this system that gave them everything to the point now they have nothing.
Why do you want to censor me? If you don't like what I'm saying, debate me. Why are they so scared of debates? I have to fight tooth and nail to get a liberal on my show. Kurt Metzger over at Race Wars, who does a podcast, he's a liberal. Him and his black comedian friend, Sherrod Small, they have to lay out little breadcrumbs like a squirrel to get a feminist on their show, because liberals are petrified of debate because they don't know what they're talking about. And I don't even think they believe what they're saying.
Oh, no, they're not. Exactly. They're dumb people who just call themselves liberals. We'll be back. All right, I kind of started spinning out of control at the bottom of the first hour today when Leanne came in and showed me mainstream news articles where they're going to put women's urinals in the men's restrooms and make us all go into the same restroom in a movie theater. A movie theater is already a big enough train wreck at the end of the movie when I got to run in there and there's 20 guys. And if you're waiting on your wife or girlfriend, it takes her 15 minutes longer. Now, Alamo Drafthouse is building a new super theater with two giant, they put the blueprints out on Facebook, two giant bathrooms where you take your daughters, your son, your wife, and you're in there with all these gross guys. I mean, I'm the type of guy that just waits and drives home because I don't want to be around guys. Now women and kids, I'm not going to that movie theater. But again, yes, what kind of freakazoids are doing this? Leanne McAdoo is popping in at the bottom of the next hour. I've tried to ignore this because, man, I don't sit around talking about bathrooms. I don't like them. Hey, you want to have unisex ones? Have it like the W, but there's like 20 one-person ones. Please bring that in. Oh, excuse me. I didn't mean to get back to this. I got so much news to cover. I want to talk about Trump, the new media censorship. We were just talking, you know, earlier to the folks at Compound Media, Gavin McInnes, one of the founders of Vice, an amazing, I'd just call him a free thinker, not even libertarian or conservative, just folks that are for common sense and civilization. And Anthony Acumia, who I've known for probably, I don't know, 10 years, I probably popped in on one of his previous shows. It was one of the top ones in the country. He's been kicked off terrestrial radio because of all those rules, same ones we're under, even though we dominate the internet too. And then he got kicked off for making comments about Black Lives Matter running around killing people, saying they were acting, you know, like horrible folks, which they were. But that's better because now he's even bigger than ever. I've gone and looked at the metrics. Believe me, the spins all over the place for what they're doing at CompoundMedia.com. And this is a war. They want to shut down drugs. They want to shut down everybody. And when the head of the Federal Elections Commission, the deputy head, comes out and says, yes, I do want to regulate drugs, and these horrible right-wingers, what they're saying, it's affecting things, but I got death threats. Well, you're talking about getting rid of free speech, you demon. I mean, come on. This is what America's about. What is your problem? And so it's just out of control. They know they're losing power. They know people know they're a bunch of authoritarians. They're panicking. Now, the question is, will they win? Will we just shut up? Now, I've been ranting and probably dominating with Gavin on. So I want to give these two guys just go at it for about 10, 15 minutes before I get to some other subjects with them on whatever is front and center for them. But I'm telling you, this is an epic time to be alive. And Trump has got his problems, but he's a nationalist. He's got the power structure crap in his pants. So much exciting stuff is happening. He's going after Hillary for all the murders and the rape and the corruption. I love it. And I love Ron Paul, but I just wish he was on earlier. I wish he'd be more pro-Trump, because I'm telling you, folks, this is the nationalism we need. Let me just say, Anthony, great having you on here. And Gavin's riding shotgun with us. Let me ask you, What do you think of the Trump phenomenon? Where do you think this is all going? And what do you think the state of not just America, but the world is right now?
I'm loving this. I am loving it because it's time. Finally, a glimmer of light at the end of the tunnel that for over a decade, I guess it's been that we just had our freedoms taken away. And freedom of speech has been front and center on their agenda. Somebody on Twitter last night was asking me, do you really think Trump is going to change things? I said, no, Trump is just a symptom of the change that's already happening.
Yeah.
People want change. They've been slowly changing. And Trump is a symptom of that change. So I don't think he's going to change things per se, but you could feel it, can't you? You could feel their desperation. And it all.
He shows that we're angry. He shows that we're standing up, the sleeping giant.
Yes. Finally, we're looking and saying, wow, it's not all them dominating the news and whatever other alternative media is out there. It's people that are thinking like we are and like the majority of Americans are thinking. We want our freedoms back. We want
to be Tsar Nicholas II looks so pleased sitting there. Gavin, are you feeling the energy of our age shift?
This is our year. And you were talking about this with Artie Lang the other day about how he would fake his way onto job sites.
Yeah.
And he would pretend that he could do all this stuff.
Right,
and,
right.
You know, he'd get in shit later on. This is what the liberals have been doing. They said, we don't want the patriarchy. We should run the show. And we went, all right, you seem to know what you're doing. We let them on the job site. And there's just been construction mayhem for 7 years. And we're realizing, wait a minute, you were lying. You don't know what you're doing. Actually, you know what? Donald Trump personifies the patriarchy. We're bringing the patriarchy back. It was working fine.
Wow. So both of you, I mean, both smart businessmen, both smart media folks, founded your own successful media companies, you know, been around the world. In your gut, when you sit around the table talking to your girlfriend, your wife or whatever, talking to business partners, where do you really think the world's going? How do you think this fight's going to play out? What are some of the possible scenarios that are positive but also negative, Anthony?
Well, obviously, on-demand digital media is where it's at these days. People don't want to be told where, when, and what they could be watching or should be watching. Perish the thought. So I see it going that way, which opens up a lot more freedoms of expression. People are able to voice their opinions and ideology without being persecuted or fired because your boss doesn't think what you're saying is good for the company. There's a lot of good that comes of that. And again, I see this pendulum swinging, and I really do think that the free thinkers, the actual progressives, which is hilarious that they have that term stapled to them, will take hold again, and we will be able to discuss things truthfully, which is something we haven't been able to do for years. We can't talk about violence in the black community. We can't talk about things like you were just saying with the bathrooms. Like people think, you ever see that movie Starship Troopers where the men and the women are showering together and they're just talking about what they're going to do that day? It's ludicrous to think that men can interact with women like that on that kind of level. It isn't going to happen. They're trying to squash.
Can you imagine your female reporters or say, yeah, it's shower time. Let's guys, you know, my wife won't mind. Let me just get in the shower with my reporter here.
Yeah, it's ludicrous.
I mean, your wife would kill you alone. I mean, even if the guy behaved himself.
Of course. Nobody, and no one wants their children showering with some freak that doesn't know what sexuality they are. This is common sense stuff that has been thrown to the wayside over the past decade. And it's time sensibility comes back to our society.
But isn't it also proof that they're just trying to sabotage us? There's no demand. There's no problem here. There's not a bunch of trannies going, I had to go to the bathroom with a bunch of men. It was horrible. I identify as a woman. That hasn't happened. They just know it makes us mad. So they get in there and with like a little pen knife and they just sort of twist it in the hole and go, this seems to annoy you. I'm going to keep
here,
twisting
let's make
here.
Their young daughters piss in urinals. I mean, who comes up with this?
It's just willful sabotage. They're trying to annoy us, and I think it's because they have daddy issues, and we're dads, so let's mess with those guys.
Let me tell you something, Alex. I remember going to Shea Stadium when I was a kid with my dad, and that urinal experience was frightening.
Exactly. I do too.
Wanting to put their daughter now through the same trauma.
I remember going to Dallas Cowboy games at those urinals that are 20 feet long, and all these guys, and like my dad goes, "Go ahead. Imagine taking your daughter. Turn around, honey. We're gonna do it." There's all these guys. I'm sorry.
I don't want to hear a woman going to the bathroom. I'm still under the belief that bubble gum comes out of there.
Right.
Little cubes of bubble gum. I don't want to know the truth.
Anthony, you just brought back memories of all the times I was horrified at baseball and football games staring into those old rotten urinals.
It was a nightmare.
And of course, all the men were also relieving themselves, you know, farting. I mean, I'm sorry, but it was like a nerve gas room or something.
It was terrible. And now they're like, yeah, let the daughters experience this wonderfulness. No.
Listen, that's the crazy part is that, oh, my God, I don't even know what to say. Is it a plan or is it total mental illness? I mean, which one is it?
Look, they're like Islam. The left is insatiable. And you see this with Islam. Someone has a burqa on. They've got the little garbage bag on their head. And then she's getting 20 lashes because we can see her purple socks. They are never satisfied. And the left is the exact same. They say, we need he, she, and it. We need a new gender. And then you check in 8 hours later, and there's 15 genders.
And now 50.
You can't satisfy them.
Facebook made 50.
50? That's insane. How can there be 50?
I don't think Star Trek has 50 genders.
They didn't have 50 alien species.
Right. I think Gavin's absolutely right. They're insatiable. You never see someone, one of these social justice warrior groups, that actually finish the job. They have an agenda, and they go, well, we got what we were asking for. Let's pack our bags. We're done. No, they go. They find other things to get to, find other ways to get under your skin and get their agenda across at the cost of society.
Right, because it's all about class. It's all about I'm smarter than you, and I'm telling you what the word is this week. Like with black, it was Negro, and then it was African-American, person of color. And so they have the lower classes constantly flummoxed going, what is it now?
Reading and writing and arithmetic. We learn the new words
today.
By the way, I have to apologize. I got something wrong. ABC News reports there's 58 new genders on Facebook.
Oh, sorry. Well, it probably became 58 from when you said it was 50.
Exactly. Next month, it'll be 190. All right, we're going to break here in a moment, gentlemen. And this will be your final segment together. And Anthony will continue on unless you want to stay, Gavin. I know you're a busy guy. What else is front and center for you guys? We're going to cover when we come back.
Well, I think we're ready to announce that we are coming out of the closet. We've fallen in love. It started with some, you know, tickling and stuff, and we just fell head over heels, and we're moving in together, and I'm leaving my wife, and we're starting a new family of just orphans. We're going to own an orphanage in Africa.
Well, hey, wait, that makes sense. You hear about the Guardian says there's a lot of folks turning into dogs. You guys who come out of the closet as two male dogs that are getting married.
Yeah, we're dogs.
And that you're going to use women's restrooms. Hold on. By the way, I don't want to compete with our own shows. That's what we're doing. And because it's just a war. And I just promote anything that's fighting tyranny. So we have these guys on to promote the great work they're doing. I just hope they have a billion viewers a day. And then the same thing. Buckley is doing this deal that I'm going to start doing every week with Reddit. A bunch of Reddit folks want to do it. He's met with the Reddit people. And it'll reach tens of millions of folks where we're going to do these talks for 2 hours once a week. Roger Stone exclusive. He's willing to do 2 hours tonight. That's kind of like Trump's secret brain. 2 hours with him tonight. Buckley's going to be honchoing it 7 to 9 while we have an hour of nightly news produced. So Infowars.com/show. Some of the stuff subscription like the films and rest of it if you want to support what we're doing. But whatever. Let me just read this briefly. This is the London Guardian with a straight face. This is not intentional comedy. The men who live as dogs were just the same as any person on the high street. It's easy to laugh at a grown man in a rubber dog suit chewing on a squeaky toy. Maybe too easy, in fact, because to laugh is to dismiss it, denigrate it, ignore it. The fact that many of us have found comfort and joy in pretending to be animals at some point in our lives. And it goes in to say how it's a gay lifestyle or something. Here's the deal, folks. Our government's financing people that just killed 200,000 plus Christians in Syria and rape women to death, some of them 5 years old. the headline, 100 men rape five-year-old to death. Oh, but no one cares about them. It's all about he lives off government welfare and is a dog. She poured Drano in her eyes, and the state pays for it now. It's beautiful. And if you dismiss it, you're a bigot. We're beautiful and smart because we poured Drano in our eyes. Is this a Clive Barker novel? Gentlemen, we got like 5 minutes of the segment. We're coming back with Kumi and it'd really go crazy. But Gavin, do we just counter their insanity by just saying whatever we want? And just, I mean, what do we do to defeat them, Anthony? What do we do?
Well, I think we're doing it. And I think the sensibility of the majority of people that have been quiet for so long and starting to get sick of what they're saying. You know, who cares? Like you said, who cares about a guy that wants to dress like a dog when there are real problems? And that comes from the UK, where they're being overrun by third world Muslims and losing this amazing history that was the UK. And a guy in a dog suit, like that's the distractions they're trying to throw at us to keep us off base and keep us from realizing that we're in big, big trouble.
And next, we're going to have to make a place for them to be in the, you know, to be dogs. I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir.
You hear these journalists talk and you go, no one talks like that. Like you're in a bar or you see the comments on a website and you go, I agree with all that. That's how everyone feels. And then you hear the media and you think, no one talks like that. Like 60 Minutes on Sunday, they had a thing called Inside Edge and it was all about corruption in Wall Street. Every single person in the story, from the prosecutor, the journalist, they were all Indian. But 60 Minutes just plowed through that and didn't even notice it. And you think, what are your journalistic instincts? I don't know why they were all Indian, but the story didn't cover that. There is a major war on Western culture going on in London now. And these losers, some random gay dudes put on a dog mask trying to be interesting, and they're not. There is so much interesting stuff going on, and the free market has handled that. That's why we have compound media. That's why we have InfoWars, because the supply and the demand will inexorably meet.
What do you expect them to do to try to strike back? I mean, I know censor, just get more extreme, more demanding?
Yeah, they're trying. I mean, they are trying, and they've been pretty successful over the course of the last decade. Thankfully, technology has made it possible for the average Joe to get out there and actually be heard by a lot more people these days without having to go through traditional broadcast standards or the typical thing you have to do as an on-air personality. So I think that helps a lot.
Sure, but that's why they want to bring federal control over the web. You think they'll be successful, Anthony?
Well, they'll try. I don't know how successful they're going to be. It's very difficult. You know, one thing we've learned over the course of the years, it's very difficult to silence people. You could try. You could do pretty well. But there's going to be a point where people want to be heard, and they're going to be heard. It's exactly what you've been doing. It's what we're doing here. And it's what a lot of other people are doing. And it's our right as Americans to be able to speak and be heard and listen to opposing viewpoints. And I think that's going to emerge.
Absolutely.
A lot. You're going to see a lot more of this happening.
Well, I want to thank.
That's what American culture is. We left Europe because we couldn't do what we wanted. We built a new country here. And the foundation of this country is do what you want. And to try to strip that away is un-American, and it goes against our own biology.
And notice they're trying to attack us for our greatest liberal, true liberal freedom. We said, live like you want as long as you don't hurt us. They go, we want to live like this, but you existing hurts us living like this. I mean, it's just incredible. Gavin McInnes, compoundmedia.com. Anytime you want to pop on, I'd love to get you guys on once a month or so. Thanks for your great work, and thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having us. Thanks, Al.
We're going to come back now and drill into a bunch of news with Anthony Kumia, the head honcho over there at the operation, doing a great job. We're going to talk about the election, Hillary, all the breaking news. I'm actually getting to some news straight ahead. Stay with us. You got a lot of powerful monopoly men, a lot of big combines that are set up for world government. They know how to use social envy, social warfare, class warfare. And they've taken our tax money and built public schools and colleges that are designed on record to turn people into basket case mental patients. And they've done it. So they could prey on these people, but also use them as big armies of zombie-like drooling trendies to try to enslave everybody else. It really is true. It really is happening. And the establishment worldwide is using the left as their takeover arm. They have compliant people on the right as well. But it's an amazing time to be alive. And the answer is you getting involved and not being scared of these people and just speaking out, because we are the majority of every race, color, and creed around the world. Don't want to live under all this garbage. I mean, the old Soviet Union, they take your money and make you work as a slave, but at least you went home and were a man. A woman was a woman. You had your kids. They're even taking that away now because they just want us totally alone because they're control freaks. We're going back to Anthony Cumia, founder of Compound Media. Of course, he was one of the hosts of the Opie and Anthony show and a lot of other big programs as well that reached tens of millions of people. But as he got more serious in things and, well, they had to kick the most popular guy off the show. That was on record because he dared criticize Black Lives Matter that's funded by George Soros. Maybe he'll talk about some of that today with us. But listen, they're trying to get me off the air. They've kicked me off stations all over the country. A lot of times they go, yeah, the Beck people say we're going to remove his show if you're not taking off. And I'm like, nobody else does that with Clear Channel shows but Glenn Beck. They go, it's not Clear Channel, it's Glenn Beck. And that's why I don't like him. I mean, it's like, dude, just come on. You like rip off what I cover, that's fine. And then you mix it all together with weird Oprah Winfrey stuff, and then you want me to disappear. It's like you're a body snatcher. You don't want the original there. Just go be yourself, man. But that's what we're getting to. Leanne's going to pop in here in a few minutes. Just briefly, if you want to hear more of this information and want to see us continue and have our reporters go around the country and show the anti-free speech people at the last two Trump rallies and cover Bilderberg and cover the RNC and DNC, buy the products. It's stuff you need. High-quality, non-GMO heirloom coffee, heirloom seeds. We've got really good water filtration systems at the lowest price, very high quality, that cut out all the trash, the garbage. Be smart, folks. I mean, you got to detox, and there's so much stuff in that water. 20% off Super Male Vitality, that is just concentrated, thick oil of concentrated herbs that just boost libido, energy, stamina. Just try a bottle. It's got almost 5 stars on third-party sites. It's an amazing product. Anthroplex feeds into it as well. We got 20% off on our high-quality Survival Shield Nation 99X2. That's the good halogen. It's the anti-fluoride. It's the opposite of that, but in the same family and blocks it. Check out X2 today. We also have developed in 2 years a vitamin mineral / amino acid fusion fruit punch drink where you don't drink the soda pop. You know, you don't drink all the garbage, the high fructose corn syrup. You drink this, it's totally natural. You get all the vitamins and minerals and things you need at one point, and it really is high quality. If you sign up for auto ship, you get 10% off. And you can also get free shipping on orders of $50 or more at InfoWarsStore.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. And we have the Hillary for Prison shirt that's our best-selling shirt in history. You see them all over TV, all over the Trump rallies. It's wonderful. You meet like-minded people. It takes a lot of money to fund this operation. I don't have George Soros doing it. We mainly fund it ourselves. I used to do it with sponsorship, but I couldn't expand at that level. So I got in, and I'm a free market, you know, guy selling high-quality products at InfoWarsStore.com. I want to thank you all for your support and what you've been doing, because we couldn't do it without you. Super Male Vitality is back in stock. And look, maybe you're super conservative and you like particular shows that talk about the New World Order. Or maybe you're more libertarian and like this broadcast. Or maybe you're more of a social liberal but a fiscal conservative. There's different type of broadcasts for everybody. But bottom line, we know the people running this country want to make us poor and break this nation so they can dictate terms to us going into this world government. And that's why now more than ever, I just beat this drum. Support free speech or lose it. Now, Anthony Cumia, I have been kind of ranting today, as I do. I kind of go manic on air. But there's so many other topics that I'm sure you're raising on your show. I know you raise. So I want to ask you now for the next 10 minutes or so before we go to Leanne to join us, what you're talking about on your show today, or why you think so many young people like your show. Because sure, I've seen your demographics. You got people that are 70, you know, 80 years old listening. You got a lot of folks that are 18 to, you know, 45 listening. But you also, because I know, have a ton of people 13 to say 20 listening. That excites me because they now understand the oppression happening in their schools. They understand that it's meant to make them guilty. I'm really proud that that a lot of young people are listening too. That really scares the power structure.
Yeah, absolutely. It's obviously going to be talking about Trump clinching the nomination. Not that it was any question that he would. Hillary and those pesky emails. Oh boy, She's in a bit of Dutch for that one. But again, people just don't seem to want to put any responsibility on her. They will vote for her. They will support her no matter how crooked or dishonest she comes across. What I think both of us like doing are taking these stories, whether it's political or just some of these ridiculous entertainment stories or the distractions, and go behind them a little bit. See what motivates the mass media to put these things out there. See what their motivation is. I think people like when the curtain's pulled away a little bit and you expose these mass media organizations for what they are. They're spreading propaganda. It's what they're doing constantly. They're a tool of the government. And it's dangerous. There you go. Pulling back the curtain to show the wizard back there turning those knobs. I don't know if so many people are buying it anymore. I don't think we're as bamboozled as we were just even a few years ago. And it's refreshing to see that people are waking up, because this is getting very dangerous for our personal freedoms. And we really need to be vigilant and talk about it, support shows like yours and the shows that we have here.
That really is the answer. Just don't do what they say. They're not our bosses. They claim there's no First Amendment. There still is. And just start disobeying all these unlawful directives from the establishment. And there's no way they can lock us all up. I mean, I think we're reaching that critical mass. I think earlier you guys made that point that just, you know, they tell us what to do. We don't do it anymore. Just like the whole Trump chalking situation.
Yeah. When a few years ago, it became fashionable to label us. You know, oh, he's a racist, he's a sexist, he's a homophobe, he's misogynistic. That ended the argument because the people were petrified of those labels. It would cost you your job, your reputation, or whatnot. Now people are starting to go, oh, really? Am I? Is that what I am today? And they'll continue to talk because it means nothing. It means nothing anymore. And I don't think there's that fear that they're holding over everybody's head anymore. And I see that, like I said earlier, as the light at the end of this long, dark tunnel of restriction and fear that we've had hanging over us, fear to express ourselves honestly, fear that we're going to lose our jobs and our reputation, and that's going to be on the internet and never go away. I mean, I had to literally build a facility to broadcast and be open and honest and say things I wanted to say without having that cloud over my head that I was going to be crucified for what I'm talking about. And that's how dedicated I am to not letting the people that have been in charge for the past decade or so get away with this. I want people to be able to speak openly and honestly without this retribution.
You're in a fight. You're in a fight for your life, for America's fight, you name it. You're not laying down. And we find when we stand up, the enemy starts to fall. Look at this article. Obama, world leaders are right to be rattled by Trump. I mean, the communist Chinese lecturing us about Donald Trump and saying he's Hitler when they've killed more people than anyone else in history. I mean, it's just all these other Saudi Arabia telling us who we can vote for, and then the president running around with Hillary, tattling to world leaders as if when Americans get bossed around, we're supposed to just bow down. And I mean, they really have miscalculated. They've gone too far.
They've gone too far, and people are aware of it, and they're fighting back, finally fighting back. You know, when people talk about Donald Trump and the awful things he's done, it's, oh, Donald told a beauty contest contestant she shouldn't eat so much candy. And people lose their minds. Like, this is the worst thing you could possibly do. And then you have Hillary, who was using her personal email account to send and receive some of the most top secret documents that someone in her position can get or send. And they just go, oh, this is garbage. It means nothing. It's the vast right wing conspiracy again. They have nothing on Trump. They have things that he did as a goofy personality builder years ago. There's no secrets ready to jump out of his closet. We know about him. But Hillary, it's obvious she's a liar. She is pandering to get votes, which she has always done. Learned
and
that
now she's been caught lying repeatedly. Remember, she said there was not even a separate server or email before. She's been caught. She should be put in jail. And you know what? People think she's invincible. At a certain point, the establishment's going to turn on her as well.
Yeah, I think we're seeing that. We're already seeing that. You're not seeing. Where is all that support for Hillary from people? You don't really see anybody except their dopey-ass husband that she's trotting around. The poor guy, let him sleep. He looks exhausted. But that's all you're seeing as far as supporting Hillary. I think people are pulling away. They see this change coming and don't want to get into the wrong boat.
Now, Anthony, I want to shift gears for you because I mentioned this earlier when you were on, but I actually want to show the article for TV viewers and radio listeners. I'll describe it. It's in KXAN. It's in a bunch of other local news reports, and they are openly talking about Alamo Drafthouse, a national chain that's now grown all over the United States. And they say in their new theaters, they're going to just get rid of men and women's bathrooms altogether and then get rid of most of the toilets for women and make them bend over and use a urinal. I'm not kidding. And this is incredible. They're asking for feedback, and I'm going to go over this. But the reason I raised this is I brought it up with Gavin earlier. What do you think's behind it? Because I kind of ignored this for years because I just thought it sounded so stupid. But now I turn on TV, read a newspaper. It's like another world. All I hear about is these oppressed people, and so they need to be in the bathroom with me. And then now everyone, men and women, are going to go into a big, giant bathroom. It's one thing if you have individual bathrooms. So I mentioned this earlier. And then Leanne McAdoo's here, one of our reporters, and has the article. She got upset as a woman. I mean, she can't go to the movie theater now. I mean, who's going to do this? This is crazy town. What do you think is behind this?
I think, honestly, it's to take traditional values and throw them out the window. Gender is what it is. There are men and women. The second you try to eliminate that, you're trying to eliminate the basics of our society and what keeps us together as a society, what makes a traditional family. They hate what is traditional because it's what empowers the people. It's what made this country great based on what the people in this country have done. The more you can break that traditionalism apart, the more you can kind of run your people.
Exactly. I mean, if you can say that someone being a man or woman is hurtful because someone else might not identify, that's saying my identity can't exist because of what you say you've invented. That is the most bigoted, anti-human, anti-liberal thing I could imagine. It's just so freakazoid, and they keep getting crazier by the month. I wonder what's coming next. I mean, here's KXAN Austin, and it's in all the articles. Alamo Drafthouse seeks feedback on gender-neutral bathroom. They say their new design will hopefully eliminate conflict. Yeah, eliminate conflict. That's a little joke on us. It's meant for conflict. Then it goes on to say they're a type of urinal both men and women can use. It's new territory. And it's a huge nozzle. Leanne McAdoo described this for people. I mean, this is what this cult wants us to be under now.
Actually, I can't even...
We're going to turn your mic on, guys. Or it's not fed to me. Go ahead. Go ahead, Leanne.
I can't even make out from the diagram exactly how they are expecting women to now just rearrange our anatomy in order to make this work, that women can now pee standing up. Like, how did this all of a sudden... Where does this come from?
The people are mental patients.
It's just, it's like overnight that they are trying to completely rewrite how science works. So when I have a baby someday and I ask the doctor, well, what is it, a boy or a girl? And he's going to say, you know, well, you just got to wait till find out what it decides it is.
That's a good point. Don't point the walls, you know, pink or blue. You just sit there and you wait for the government to tell you.
Right. Well, and that's the whole dehumanization thing, because if they can take away mother, father, brother, son, daughter, then it's all you're the legal guardian of this humanoid. I mean, it might not even be a person here eventually. They might rearrange.
And they're getting us ready for clones. They're getting us ready for chimeras. Right. This is just getting us ready for body augmentation. You see the newscast? Your kid will soon have a chip. I'm all for technology, but not like having a chip like my cell phone that tracks me. Anthony, let me ask you this question. When you talk to folks just on the ground in New York or Florida or you know, wherever you're visiting folks, I mean, are they getting that this stuff's going on?
Yeah, but look at how all this stuff has been presented over the years. You're talking about putting chips in people and children, and it's always presented as a convenience and new technology to help you. Mm-hmm. No one ever goes, hey, the government wants you to go to this building and have a chip put in you. People would go, what are you, out of your mind? Yet we've been presented with our phones, which is literally a tracking system. It puts out to the world what we eat, when we sleep, where we go, our families, our friends, our political affiliation, all this stuff. If you told someone years ago that you would carry a device with all your information on it, pictures, all your preferences, you'd say, get out of here. I'm not going to do that. Mm-hmm. Well, it's always presented as a convenience. You need this. And we eat it up.
It's a doppelganger.
You have to be vigilant.
Wow, the way you put that, it's so true. It literally now, the new iPhones for a couple of years, tracks your heart rate, when you eat, where you go. I mean,
soon we won't be able to live without it. So, I mean,
After a little time goes by and it's been this convenience that now you can't even leave the house without your phone. You lose your mind. So what they do then is say, well, do you realize this could be used? Like you say, it tracks your health, maybe your heart rate, this, whatever other biometrics. Do you think that at some point won't be used to deny you insurance?
They're going to know you drank beer, you ate steak. Leanne, we're going to break. I'm going to come back and ask you both, though. But now, how do we counter this? I mean, I'm not going to the Alamo Draft House anywhere. If they start opening locations where my daughters have to go into bathrooms with men and squat over urinals.
Right. That's what I'm saying. Like, this is so new, this whole transgender thing. It's really still, you know, in a state of confusion. And yet they are rearranging bathrooms. They're writing federal laws. Like, where is this going? Where is this going to end? I mean, we're just now witnessing the beginning of this.
They admit in the Pentagon documents we've covered it 30 years ago, the globalist plan to make us asexual, where finally there's just no sex. You're not allowed, and we're going to drug you. THX1138, I see Anthony Cumia nodding his head. We're going to come back with himself and Leanne straight ahead. Then David Knight's coming up. And I shot a special report that is so important where Donald Trump destroys the New World Order. We're going to be airing that as well. All right, Anthony Cumia is our guest. Got to get him back up more often. Really had a lot of fun talking today. David Knight's coming up. They're going to air a special report I shot that's going viral all over the internet. Tea Party News has picked it up. A bunch of other huge sites. It's going to get tens of millions of views. Trump exposes globalist coup inside America. I want to change it to over America. Elite in full panic mode. We're going to air that report. It's about 7 minutes long the next hour when David Knight takes over. Also, we've got a lot of other big news. I should have got into TSA and 70,000 people missing the flights in the last year and how they're demanding more money from Congress and the border's open and they're letting jihadists in. So we'll talk some about that. But just finishing up, Leanne, you had one other point you were going to make to Anthony on the whole thing about women have been forced to use urinals, and it's going to be weird, man. I already see it. You walk in, there's like women in the restroom. It's like, what's going on here?
Well, there's just a story that came out. A Saudi man shoots the doctor shortly after the doctor delivered his wife's baby because he didn't want a man to see his spouse naked. So, I mean, here you have people who are so terrified of having anyone see anything beyond a woman's eyes, and now you're going to force them to use all the bathrooms?
I mean, it's a mental illness. Saudi Arabia is completely mentally ill. And I'm bigoted for saying that. No, they're complete fruits. The Nazis were crazy. The Aztecs were nuts. People go crazy.
Yeah.
Why not admit Saudi Arabian people under this government are nuts? Anthony, I want to get some into the TSA. We were almost out of time, but we were getting into all this, and I forget the point before I went to break, but there's just so much going on. It's like crazy people are taking over.
Yeah, the TSA thing. I mean, not only are the lines ridiculous, everybody that goes to the airport realizes there's got to be a better way. And it's not working. I mean, there's something like a 98% failure rate when they test the TSA agents with explosives.
They've never caught one terrorist.
So it's not even working. We're all waiting on these lines, and it's a dog and pony show. To make us feel good and feel safe, it's not working.
Well, I mean, in Europe, you go over there now, and it's mainly the jihadis that run the security.
I don't know what kind of psychopath you'd have to be to fly out of De Gaulle Airport at this point. They have people on the airport's payroll that are jihadis. I don't understand. Well, you don't want to offend people? You'd rather blow up at 37,000 feet than offend somebody because you're questioning.
I think that's it. This is the global takeover of wimps. I mean, a lot of this is just capitulation. It's like the Germans. You have seen the video where the jihadis on TV is the government minister over immigration? And they go, soon all you evil Germans will be gone. And the Germans clap.
They're clapping at their own extermination, which is ironic, but they are. I can't understand people that applaud and feel good about their culture, their history, their ancestry being erased. I don't get it.
Well, it's progressive and loving to hate yourself.
The truth is, I mean, I'm here to say it. I never used to bash the left. I mean, I didn't like them, but I was just more libertarian. These people are demons. I mean, and they're mentally ill, and it's like Gavin was saying, they have daddy issues. They just want to overthrow everything because they can't build anything. So they see the civilization, and they get scared by it, like, freedom, what do? Bring in the jihadis. Right. You know, put beekeeper suits on the women.
Right, and they'll wait to collapse our society until they can disarm us. Like,
well, we're fighting back, and the world is waking up, and I just want to thank our guests for joining us. Closing comments, Anthony, it's great having you. Thanks for the time.
Well, when you look at what's happening, like at the Alamo Draft House, and what we've seen over the past 10 years with trying to squash people's freedom of expression and voicing their opinions, it's doing away with identity. They don't want us to have an identity. And traditional identities, a family, a man, a woman, the kids, is a bad word. You can't, that's looked at as something terrible. Meanwhile, when you look around the world, that's what built it. That's what built all the that's amazing right. things. Yet now it's a bad thing. Mm-hmm. So all these little tricks that you see, they're trying to do away with people's identity.
Hold on, you're not done. Do five more. You got to go understand. Five more with us. And then, by the way, Ask Me Anything with Roger Stone tonight, hosted by InfoWars on Reddit. Free video feeds, InfoWars.com/show, 7 to 9 tonight. And we'll have nightly news on top of it. So it's just an orgy of info. Stay with us. Anthony Kumi is our guest. Leanne McAdoo's here. David Knight is walking in about 4.5 minutes to sit in this seat and take over. I did a pretty good job having a fun show today. I didn't cover as much news as I should have because, quite frankly, it's traumatic to read 100 or 200 articles and come in here and try to cover it. Anthony, you were getting into the assault on just being real, being independent. They're trying to domesticate us is what I thought you were getting at. And I think there's a rebellion against that. And once humans realize, every race, color, and creed, religion, that you are under attack, humans love to fight. And once we know we're in a fight, we start winning.
Well, that's why they outlawed fist fighting.
Yeah, when you get... it's an assault on people's individuality, too. Innovation, people being clever, people being unique. That's it. They want to lump us into a group that can easily be, it's easier to lead a group of people than it is a bunch of individuals. Mm-hmm. So that's what they're doing. Whether it's making a one sex bathroom or just squashing people's freedoms and the freedom to voice opinions or invent, be innovative, have ideas. That seems to be the bad thing. We're in a topsy-turvy world. The victims are the bad guys. The perpetrators are the victims. And when they throw us off base like that, it's easier to guide us in a direction they want.
Sure. You've been super successful for decades in radio. I don't know all the numbers. I know you've been really big, so I know you could have retired, right?
Oh, yeah. I could have retired a while ago, especially on that last outing where I was fired for merely tweeting something.
Exactly. So let me guess, though. I just see the buzz on the street. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, because I know you're an honest guy. Are you reaching as many or as much or more people now since you went completely independent? Because, I mean, I'm hearing more about you than I ever heard. So
we're almost 2 years into this venture at this point, so... Honestly, I don't think I'm reaching as many people as I did on satellite or especially broadcast radio.
No, I was talking about satellite, not broadcast, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure we're closing in on it, and I see this growing. This is something I'm very happy with, very proud of, and it is. It's got a buzz. People are finally realizing, hey, there are some places out there where people are speaking openly, honestly, without repercussions.
Yeah, because I used to hear some buzz about your show, but I'll be honest, some smart people, mainly a lot of trendies, and you know, they just like the dirty jokes or, you know, tranny jokes or whatever, which is fine with me. It's just, you know, everybody can have their own free speech. But now that you guys are getting hardcore, a lot of the thinking folks are paying attention, so that's a good thing. And I'd rather have one thinking person than, you know, two idiots listening.
Yeah, well, you know what? Years ago, you could shock people on the radio, and that was our job. Now, two clicks of a mouse or on your phone, you're seeing stuff that would shock anybody. So that's kind of a done deal. I like the idea of coming on here and talking about things that are pretty important.
But you always kind of did that. Whenever I was on your show, you were kind of the guy getting into serious stuff.
Yeah, yeah. I was always the one that wanted to tackle some of these issues. And, you know, people wanted to hear dick jokes. But, you know, it kind of works out here.
All right. Well, listen, we really appreciate the work you're doing. It's good to have more folks out there fighting tyranny. And God bless you, Anthony. We appreciate your time.
Thanks, Alex.
Well, there he goes, compoundmedia.com. And again, we do this. We have other people on that are talking about the censorship, the tyranny who've been censored. Because we're all in this together, folks. I mean, these idiots go, I hope they shut Drudge down or Limbaugh down. We'll have more clicks. No, they'll get us next. They have no common sense here.
Exactly, yeah.
And that, but even if I would profit from that, I wouldn't want that to happen. It's called empathy.
Well, that's what people love about Trump so much, is he's saying what the media has been trying to suppress for so long. And they're not winning. They're losing because they're losers.
That's right. Leanne, you're doing a great job. Coming up tonight, 7 o'clock Central, on Top of the News. It'll be the news and this. Ask Me Anything, Roger Stone, at least an hour of it. They're saying 2 hours of it. Infowars.com/show. And, of course, the nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock. Who's hosting that? That'll be Leanne McAdoo.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In the fourth hour, we keep adding additional things to the broadcast. We've added the fourth hour. Tonight, we're going to try something new. As Alex has pointed out, we're going to have an Ask Me Anything session on Reddit with Roger Stone that we're going to broadcast live. And, of course, we have that graphic that's up there. One thing that's not on the graphic is it is 7 p.m. Central Time. 7 p.m. Central Time. We're going to have Roger Stone on for a couple of hours, Ask Him Anything on Reddit, and that's going to combine the best aspects of the internet and being able to ask people things instantaneously and then have a live response there that you'll be able to see on video. Now, this hour, we're going to be talking to John McAfee at the bottom of the hour. He is one of the candidates running for the Libertarian Party. The Libertarian Party begins their convention tomorrow in Orlando. They're going to choose their nominee at convention. They don't have the primary functions or the caucus elections state by state. They do it for the national party. They do it at convention. It's going to be very interesting. Of course, Gary Johnson was the candidate 4 years ago. He appears to be in the lead at this point. But I think there's a lot that John McAfee has to say, actually. I'm quite interested in talking to him. He's the person out of all the Libertarian candidates that I'm the most interested in, because I believe that John McAfee is pulling the Libertarian Party, if he gets their nomination, he could pull the Libertarian Party into the 21st century. In far too many areas, Libertarian Party is still debating the academics of issues that were with us 20 years ago when I was active with them. They really have not been involved with some of the key core issues that we're faced with today. Things that are taking over our lives, that are laying the groundwork for tyranny. And of course, that is primarily in the electronics area, in the surveillance area, in the dragnet surveillance area that we've got. So I want to talk to him a lot about that. Yeah, he's somebody that understands that, of course, better than pretty much anybody else on the planet. He's one of the international experts on security, cybersecurity, what is possible, what is not possible. And of course, this is an individual who has been under the gun of the government. He hasn't been a politician. He has been the target of politicians. That will make you a libertarian. So he feels it in his gut, just as Lily Tang Williams, that we talked to, is running for Senate in Colorado. She grew up under Mao, under the Cultural Revolution in China. She knows what it's like to be a slave. She said she's not going to be a slave again. He knows what it's like to be hunted by the government, and he doesn't want to see that happen again either. We're going to play a report from Alex Jones in just a moment. Before we do, though, I want to talk about what we've got back in stock. We do have Super Male Vitality is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. This has been out of supply for over a month. And, of course, if this is something that you use on a regular basis, you should try our products. You like the products. You like what they do for you. Sign up for AutoShip. Not only does it get you a 10% discount, but it makes sure that it never goes out of stock for you. So Super Male Vitality has been out of stock, but it is now back in stock for limited time only, unless you sign up for auto ship. Also, we have a Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, 20% off. We've extended that sale. That's our Nascent Iodine. A great time to stock up on an emergency preparedness item that you need to have, a health item that you need to have, and that is Nascent Iodine in your, I guess you could call it your medicine chest or your food supply. One of the articles that we're looking at today that came out, which I think is very relevant to what we're going to be talking to John McAfee about, is this is a Wired magazine article. A car's computer can fingerprint you in just minutes based on how you drive. Isn't that interesting? We're going to talk about this more after the report, but I wanted to just give you a little bit of a tease of this. The government, or the security experts, let's say, they can identify you, of course, with a lot of different biometric identifiers. They can look at your eyes, they can look at your ears, they can look at your face, okay? They can identify you by your walk. Now they can identify you in an incredibly short period of time by the way you drive. And just by looking at the way you apply the brakes, and this has massive privacy ramifications for us in our lives. The way the insurance companies and government will regulate us, it's just the tip of the iceberg of where we're going to go. But before we go to that, when I'll talk about that in the next segment, but I want to play this report because Donald Trump clinched the nomination of 1,237 delegates at Ayshad's speech. Alex Jones breaks this down. He exposes the globalist coup over America, the elite in full panic. Here's our report.
The establishment is in panic mode like it's never been before. In the last 24 hours, the New York Times, CNN, MSNBC, and many other establishment media outlets all came out and said, we're in panic mode. Donald Trump is channeling Alex Jones. Donald Trump's getting his worldview from Infowars.com.
And any sort of conspiracy theory, anything from the 80s, the 90s, or even beyond, I think is just continuously stoking that.
But this also just feels very narrowcast to me. I mean, this really is like, I really think, and it's been amazing to watch this. I mean, you got Alex Jones, who I've been watching a lot recently. He's like the main conspiracy theorist, the sort of probably the most popular in American life right now. You know, Roger Stone goes on that show every day. Right. There's this crazy vortex of all that stuff back from the 90s and Dan Burton firing a gun, you know, into a pumpkin or whatever the hell it was. All of that stuff, which has been simmering there forever and Judge has stoked, is now sort of exploding through the channel of Trump. And part of the challenge, Michael, is straight.
He's talking about the JFK assassination. He's talking about Clinton's killing people and rape. Oh my gosh, it's so terrible. It's so horrible. What do we do? Well, the majority of Americans know the government killed Kennedy. It's over 90% in polls. The Clinton scandals with the mysterious deaths and everything are incredibly famous. The term ARK incited. He's talking about things that the majority of Americans know are going on. And what's happening is the facade of the mainstream media is falling, and they're figuring out the facade is falling because when they criticize Trump for talking about these things, he gets more popular. The tide has now officially turned. They keep trying to turn the tide back, and it's not working. Am I proud of the fact that they're saying, you know, Trump gets his worldview from Alex Jones? Yes, but that's not even true. My worldview of how the globalists operate in history is mainly off declassified documents, congressional hearings. It was declassified in the 1960s and in the 70s in the church hearings that the CIA put out the term conspiracy theorist to criticize even mainline investigative journalists that were exposing opium coming out of Vietnam and things like that. This just all happened. They've been caught over and over again. That's their term. And now Trump comes in, amplifies what I'm saying, what Drudge Report and Matt Drudge is saying, and just common sense stuff, and it's blown past them, and their facade has collapsed. It was always a facade, but now it's blown over. And Trump is hitting a whole new demographic worldwide. Even if he was a sellout, even if he's a bad guy, which I don't think he is, I think the guy's a hero, he's doing irrevocable damage to him. This is an incredible time to be alive, and the info war has never been exploding faster. We're getting like triple the traffic we got 6 months ago. It's just amazing how mainline our information is going. Mainline libertarians, mainline conservatives, mainline anti-war patriots, Amish-type folks, folks that are into being natural and organic, they're all awake. But they were already awake. I didn't wake them up. I was just a prominent person putting the information out and organizing it and having great reporters like our crew and you, the listeners, getting the info out. We're all a family, every race, color, and creed, part of this fight. And history is happening. This is the potential beginning of 1776 part two. They're going to crash economies. They're going to start big wars. They're going to pull out the stops, folks. But we know that they try to use these crises, both manufactured and real, to get more power. And that's why they're being defeated.
And the guys, oh, no, not another one. Where is he? How old is this kid? How old is this kid? Get out of here. Get out of here. Still wearing diapers. Look at this kid. Telling you, the kid looks like he's 10 years old. I've never seen that. It's unbelievable. That's the youngest protester I've ever seen. Actually, Ted Cruz had a very young one also. I've never seen anybody like that. All right.
Trump is just mainlining what the majority of Americans are already concerned about. And we're tired of being lied to. And the system is in full panic mode, turning all these thugs loose to try to go shut down free speech rallies and more, and that's only backfiring. The system is so scared right now. But bottom line, America's culture is a conspiracy culture since 1776, when we were ruled by a faraway land, by a faraway empire. We were born out of not trusting the government and wanting a small government. We're just rediscovering who we were and what made us great. We've been occupied by multinational globalists that say they're establishing a world government. And everything from the New York Times to the Financial Times of London. Then we say we don't want to be part of an unelected world government, and you call us dangerous terrorists. In the Washington Post 3 days ago.
Is this global governance at last? Is it one world, the central bankers in charge? But aren't we all just living and dying for what the central banks do?
Of course we are. We are absolutely slaves to central banks.
You people want to have a full takeover of America when you've already seized its institutions. You want to shut down free speech. We're not flat-footed. We warned everybody. Patriots 60 years ago got the word out. And now we held your system back for so long. It finally is getting here. You're behind schedule, but people are now awake and were warned that you were coming and what your system would be. People like Ron Paul 30, 40 years ago, people like, oh, it's just amazing. People like Barry Goldwater 50 years ago, they were so on target. And we stand on their shoulders today. This is just an incredible time. So spread the word. People are ready to wake up to the fact that we have an occupied government of takeover artists, and we're going to restore our republic if we understand these people are illegitimate, break the trance, and take our republic back. Their takeover was so big and so over the top, that was its advantage because it was just so incredible. But once the hoax that it doesn't exist is gone, it's game over. Infowars.com is just one key outpost in this fight. Please intensify our efforts against the globalists, restore our republic, and free the world from the hands of the New World Order.
All right, that's Alex Jones' report about Donald Trump. We're going to be talking to one of the nominees for the Libertarian Party nomination coming up at the bottom of the hour, John McAfee. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In the next segment, we're going to be joined by John McAfee, security expert, presidential candidate for the Libertarian Party. They're going to begin their convention tomorrow. They will choose a nominee over this weekend. And I want to ask John McAfee questions about a wide variety of issues when he joins us in the next segment. But one of the key things that I want you to understand is just how much not only the Libertarian Party needs John McAfee, but how much America needs his voice in this discussion. We are seeing very disruptive technologies coming at us very quickly, growing so quickly that most of us don't really understand what's going on with it. And we don't understand the implications of it. Let me explain this to you. I teased this a little bit in the very first segment. A car's computer can fingerprint you in minutes based on how you drive. This is an article from Wired Magazine today. You know, they're able to identify you by your walk. Well, how about the way you drive? They say the way you drive is surprisingly unique. Automobiles have become data harvesting mobile computers. Yes. You need to understand that. The data collected by your car, whether you own it or whether you rent it or whether you borrow it, can probably identify you based on that driving style after as little as just a few minutes behind the wheel. This is a study done by a group called Privacy Enhancing Technology Symposium. They're going to present it in Germany this July. I'm sorry, that's the symposium where they're going to present the study. The study was done by the University of Washington and California at San Diego. They say they can fingerprint drivers based only on the data they collect from internal computer network of the vehicle their test subjects were driving. This is what's known as the car's CAN bus, C-A-N bus, okay? They say the data collected from a car's brake pedal alone, the brake pedal alone, can identify you. And they did this with 15 individuals, and they can identify you 90% of the time after just monitoring the way you apply the brakes for 15 minutes. If they're given 90 minutes to watch the way you drive, they can identify you fully 100% of the time. Think about that. Just 90 minutes, they can identify everybody after 90 minutes of watching the way they apply the brake pedals. Now, here's the implication of this. The researchers argue that the ability to pinpoint could have unexpected privacy implications. Everything from letting insurance companies punish the drivers who loan their cars to their teenage kids to confirming the identity of a driver who violated traffic laws or who caused a collision. But the fingerprinting study, they say, should serve as a more general warning to car owners about the sensitivity of data that travels across their vehicle's internal networks. Those networks are not going to remain internal much longer. The Department of Transportation, the Federal Department of Transportation, is already working on standards that they're going to mandate on cars. These standards will be identified later this year in the fall. Vehicle-to-vehicle communications, where the cars will be talking to each other. But those cars will soon be talking to the infrastructure. It's called vehicle-to-infrastructure, V2I. At that point, they are going to be talking directly to your government regulators, your government minders, your government masters, because that's what they will turn into. They say the same data that tells the insurance company when you've let your 16-year-old kid take the car to the prom might easily be used to identify drunk driving or a medical condition that's altered someone's driving ability. They say drivers are increasingly sending that sensitive data to the cloud with gadgets like Hum, Venly, Automatic, and Zuby, designed to be plugged into the car's CAN network via a port under the vehicle's dashboard. Other OBD2 devices are being offered by insurance companies like Progressive and Metromile. That's where they give you the little dongle thing that you stick in and say, well, we'll give you lower insurance rates. Yeah, we'll see how long that lasts. Understand that cars like Tesla are uploading this data right now automatically. For what purpose? How will this be used? How will this be misused? I reported yesterday about how the feds are flashing their badges on auto data. This is a report from Automotive News. They said back in February, before all this dispute that John McAfee got involved in between Apple and the FBI demanding the information from these San Bernardino shooters' phones, before that happened, they called all these automotive executives into Quantico, Virginia to talk to the FBI, their headquarters, and said, we want you to work with us. And these people were very uncomfortable with this, so much so that they contacted Automotive News and said anonymously, I feel very uncomfortable with where we're at, one industry official said. He said, there's a lot of pressure on the auto industry to do a better job with security. At the same time, we're being told by the government, you guys are getting better at security, and that's messing us up. They don't want security. They want to know everything about you. This is a big brother government. And here's the bottom line, folks. They spelled out in this article. Your car essentially knows where you sleep, where you work, where you eat, where your kids go to school, where you go to church, if you're having an affair, you name it. Hey, guys, there are multiple ways. It's not just your phone, it's your car, all these different ways that the government has of tracking you. And we've had people like James Clapper say, oh, we're not recording your phone calls, we're just looking at your metadata. That's how they get you. That's how they monitor and control you and profile you. And it can be a very dangerous thing if it generates a false positive and you get SWAT teamed or you get identified as a terrorist by these people because they don't like your political views. They know your political views. It's called human intelligence, okay? It's called geo-intelligence. It's called activity-based intelligence. And this is a broad spectrum. If we don't get control of this politically, it will control us. Stay with us. We'll be right back with John McAfee. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight. In this segment, we're going to be talking to John McAfee. We haven't established connection with him just yet. We're having a little bit of trouble with the electronics communication with Skype. But of course, the government's not having too much problems with that. This is very key because we've got the Libertarian Nomination Convention going on this weekend, beginning tomorrow. And of course, we're seeing a spike with the Libertarian Party. Typically last year, they were getting about 100 new members a month. It was reported by The Hill that in January, they got 148, went up to 323 in February, March 706, April 1293. So 13 times the amount that they were getting average on a month preceding year. And that's just in the first 3 weeks of May. Now, what does the Libertarian Party have? It has 50 state ballot access. That's something that is very difficult to do, but they've been able to achieve that. And the even more difficult thing to do because of corruption is to get access to the debates. But that's something that will have to be addressed on a different issue. The Libertarian Party is a factor because it does have 50 state ballot access. And let me introduce John here a little bit. I think this op-ed piece that he wrote for Newsweek back at the beginning of May was very good. He says, I might be a political hotshot, but I'm not Charlie Sheen. He said, he's done a lot of things in his life. And of course, his biography here, we've got he was employed beginning as a NASA programmer from 68 to 70. From there, he went to Xerox as an operating systems architect. Then in 87, he founded the company that is named after him, McAfee, the computer antivirus company. He sold that for a lot of money. In 1989, he went to Lockheed, began, I'm sorry, he 1989, he quit Lockheed. He began working full time for his company and eventually sold that. And then he, in, as recently as 2010, he started a new venture in the field of bacterial quorum sensing, whatever that is. We won't get into that kind of detail in the weeds. But you can find him on his website at bealibertarian.com, bealibertarian.com. Now, he points out, he says, I'm familiar with business, having started 17 in my life, almost all successful, one of them now worth more than $1 billion. The fourth company I founded, McAfee, was sold to Intel for more than $7 billion a few years ago. I've started many companies now worth more than $100 million, so I know a little bit about business. McAfee went on to say, corporate competition is fierce. Many view it as economic warfare. But he says politics is something unique. And so he talks about how recently he's experienced mudslinging, where someone attacked him by comparing him to Charlie Sheen, unflatteringly. He says he admires Charlie Sheen as an actor. He doesn't make any judgments about his reported use of drugs or his proclivity for prostitutes. He says, I'm a libertarian after all. Libertarians believe no one should live one's life, that everyone should live their life as they please, provide they harm no one else. He says, as to his alleged craziness, I don't know him personally, but as for me, I've written over 100 articles in the past 3 years for International Business Times, Business Insider, Digital Trends, SiliconANGLE, Forbes, and Newsweek. If any of that sounds crazy, then perhaps I am. Joining us now is John McAfee. Welcome, Mr. McAfee.
Thank you very much. I'm happy to be here.
I'm very interested to hear your voice. I think the Libertarian Party needs your voice. I think America needs your voice in the discussion. We are threatened with a lot of vital issues. I think the border issues, the trade issues that we see that Donald Trump has tapped into, I think those are vital issues. But there's another vital issue that nobody is talking about, and that is the big brother aspect of massive surveillance. And there's many other issues that I don't really see candidates like Gary Johnson addressing. 4 years ago when he was running, he basically focused his campaign on government redefining marriage, on being pro-abortion, and on pot legalization, which is fine, except that those first two things are not even necessarily something that all libertarians agree on. We had pro-life libertarians when I was in the Libertarian Party. A lot of people don't believe that the government should have any role in defining marriage. And when it comes to pot legalization, that's fine. But I think we need to focus on the broader problems of drug prohibition in general. Then I was very disturbed to see that he's picking William Weld, a guy who has supported assault weapon bans. He has supported other gun control measures. He supported the Iraq War 10 months after the invasion. He's failed to oppose the Patriot Act. As a matter of fact, he worked as a DEA enforcer for Ed Meese. And this is a guy who gave us a civil asset forfeiture. Now, he eventually forced Ed Meese out for personal corruption charges, but he should have forced him into jail for giving us something like civil asset forfeiture. So I'm very disturbed to see the Libertarian Party moving in the direction of having these career politicians, which is what Gary Johnson and William Weld are, in my opinion. I think they need to be brought into the 21st century with issues like you're addressing. Talk to us about the vitality of cybersecurity and what we need to do to protect us from the government.
Well, with your permission, sir, I'd like to talk some about something far more important.
Sure.
We're talking about issues, but there's an issue that absolutely no one has addressed, and that is that when Dwight Eisenhower left office in the 50s, he warned us about something called the military-industrial complex. That connection between government and industry, which would only cause greater power in both of those. Gary Johnson talks about presidential debates. If we don't get into the debate, we're lost, so he's suing the debate commission. Well, we know that's not going to go to court until after the election. We know how the court process works, so it's utter nonsense. At the Las Vegas debate that Penn Jillette of Penn and Teller put together, I did the debate like everybody else. In my closing statement, I got up and said, what you have watched is utter complete nonsense, fabricated by the media in the 60s and perpetrated by the media for the media. And let me explain. What do you have in a presidential debate? You have opening statements and closing statements written by speech writers, not the candidate himself. You have a candidate that has been coached by dozens in and.
As a matter of fact, I think we lost transmission there for a moment. One of the founders of the Libertarian Party was a speechwriter for Goldwater, who had that famous comment, extremism in defense of liberty is no vice, and moderation in defense of justice is no virtue, if I got that correct. I may not have gotten that exactly right, but you're exactly right. And, so it's the speechwriters.
So the point is, by buying into this media industry government complex, we'll learn. If, in fact, we elect these candidates, we should move the speechwriter and his coaches into the Oval Office and put the candidate out. We know nothing.
I liked Carl Hess even better than Barry Goldwater when I met him.
So I made the comment in my closing statement, I would sign a form today with every media outlet giving them the right to break into my house at 6 o'clock in the morning, film me in bed when I have a hangover, or come in while I'm arguing with my wife, or scolding the dog. Wouldn't you learn more? No, this debate structure, 2 minutes opening statement, 45 second response, et cetera, is nonsense structured by the media with their gaps for commercials. And it tells us nothing about the candidates. The political process in America is broken, pure and simple. Why do you think Donald Trump gets the support that he gets? He's not a politician. Now, he's the deal maker, which is half of politics, but you don't, has been tainted by and become part of that machine, which is America's political nightmare. So I'm not playing by this game. And like I said, I suffered the debate after I participated and trashed the debate and apologized personally to Penn Jillette afterwards, because I know he put lots of money, time, and effort into that debate in Las Vegas.
Sure, I understand. So, yeah, we're trying to see a contrast and a comparison of ideas, and it's just it's an imperfect form. One of the problems with it is that it's not a true debate, and that's why you have these sound bites that are put out there, because the format that we use is not like you would see in a college debate format where somebody's got a premise and you have a back and forth and they are able to engage each other. Instead, they're asked these questions by moderators who have their own agenda and they don't really follow the issues. So I'd like to ask you about some specific issues, if you'd like to talk about that.
I'm ready. Go ahead, sir.
Okay, let's talk about, we'll get to the security issue, but let's talk first about something I haven't heard anybody really talk about much. That's mandatory vaccines. It seems like that'd be something that the Libertarian Party would be talking about. What's your position on that, as well as things like mandated government health insurance, Obamacare?
Okay, I believe, and all libertarians, and not just libertarians, I think all people have some sense that their bodies and their minds belong to themselves. I do. I was born with it. I think all kids have it. You may disagree, but if they don't belong to me, maybe they belong to my mom and dad. But they certainly don't belong to a neighbor or you, or certainly not to a government. So when you tell me that you're going to stick a needle into a body that I own and vaccinate me for my own good, I'm going to say F you and get the F off of my property. Why? Because look at the realities. If the vaccines do in fact work, then why are people upset if a few people choose not to take them?
Yeah, exactly.
They're going to get sick and die, but it's not going to affect you. And if they don't work, then it was an improper move to force everyone to be vaccinated. This is a non-issue, sir. It's a non-issue if we look at it realistically.
Good, good. That's a great answer. Let me ask you about mandated health insurance, for example, Obamacare. I'm assuming that you would say the government should not be able to force us to purchase something like that. What would you do with the health system in order to appease the things that people think that they're going to get out of the quote-unquote Affordable Health Care Act?
Well, that's odd that you asked that. 2 years ago, I was on Neil Cavuto's Fox News, and he asked me about Obamacare. And I said, well, number one, the website is a hacker's wet dream. And he said, I don't believe you said that. But I did. What right does government have to mandate anything? Did we elect this government to be our mother and father or our boss? I certainly didn't. Maybe you did. When our Constitution was formed, the government was a service organization. George Washington was pushed kicking and screaming into the job. Who wants the job of serving 3 million people?
Yes, absolutely. And that's the problem is they tried to manage this, and there isn't anybody that is capable of managing the lives of hundreds of millions of people. There's not any bureaucracy that's capable of doing that as well.
Oh, we are living under a delusion.
Yes.
They tell us the police are here to protect us. Well, I ask you, someone breaks into your head, where is the magic button that you put?
Yeah, exactly.
It's realized between you.
It's the magic button that opens up my gun safe. That's why I did it for
that's it. That's the thing. Okay.
Yeah.
And by the way, you mentioned guns. Good Lord, we are libertarians. I have not met a single libertarian that does not believe we have the right to own and bear arms. And Gary Johnson picks a man who doesn't want anyone under 21 having a gun, who doesn't believe that firearms are necessary unless they're used for hunting. Holy heck.
Yes. Well, I think the important thing that you and I are missing there, John, is that he picked somebody who was a two-term governor. That was far more important than what he believed about the Second Amendment, apparently.
Well, here's the thing. Being a two-term governor is a negative this year. Please don't understand this.
Especially if it's Massachusetts.
America, we are sick of politicians and governors and mayors and anybody tainted and polished by the political process. So it's insane.
As a matter of fact, when Reason Magazine looked at Gary Weldon and William Weldon talked about his tenure as governor, they said, the Libertarian Party likes to talk about how they're fiscally conservative, socially liberal. Well, he's socially liberal in a Michael Bloomberg kind of way.
Yes.
And that's precisely it. Yeah.
Scary. It's utterly scary. So here's what happened. The Libertarians have been around for a long time. This is Gary's second attempt to be nominated. What happens when you decide to take a slow, careful step into revolution? Because really, libertarianism is a revolutionary idea. We want to completely change the way our government functions. When you take these slow, careful steps, like Gary and the party has been doing, you end up with compromise. All change of a radical nature in all of human history that is attempted in a slow step-by-step process has resulted in that movement being absorbed in the power there through compromise.
We're seeing
that the convention has not even happened. And already we have someone who is absolutely not a libertarian running as vice president.
Exactly.
We can't do that.
I agree with you completely. And I think you really hit the nail on the head. What we're looking at here is a takeover by the establishment. It's not an advantage to have two-term governors from a Democrat state running for your party. Only the Washington insiders would believe that. Let's talk a little bit about the surveillance state. Is Snowden a hero or a traitor?
Good Lord. Let's get real. If a man comes to you...
Did we lose you? Are you there? I just wanted to get that answer. We're talking to John McAfee. Do we lose him, guys? Is he still on the line? Or are we getting a little bit sketchy with his phone? We just lost him. Okay, they're going to try to reestablish connection with John McAfee. But I want to ask him about this because, Alex alluded to this in his report about the Church Committee hearings, the Pike Committee hearings. They knew back in the 70s that the government was illegally surveilling American citizens. That was one of the things that started the Church Committee hearings in the Senate, the Pike Committee hearings in the House. The Pike Commission called the NSA chief in to talk to them, and they asked to see their charter. And he said, I'm not going to show it to you. We were created by executive order by President Truman, and I'm not even going to show you my charter. That's the arrogance of the NSA in the 1970s. It's only gotten worse. They decided that they would go through and they would try to establish law to control this criminal, secret, dark government that had been that had already created metastasized after about two decades. So they created the FISA Act. That's the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. Part of that was going to be a court that would hear secret testimony. If they wanted to spy on somebody and it was a matter of intelligence, they wanted to set up a due process case with that. So they created a court in order to hear that, in order to give the warrant. Now what has happened? We now have this organization, and I'm notified that John is back with us. We now have this organization that is acting as a star chamber, operating in secret, making these dragnet surveillance warrants that are going all over the entire country, as well as claiming that they're modifying the Constitution with their secret rulings. There's not even any opposition. Let's go back to John McAfee. We lost you as you were talking. I had asked you if John Snowden is a hero or a traitor.
Oh, Edward, okay. If someone knocks on your door and says, I have to tell you something, it's extremely important. I have discovered that your government, whose charter, a piece of your government, the NSA, whose charter is to get collect evidence on foreign threats, is spying on you. Now, you go, oh, you're a traitor. No, you go, thank you. For God's sake, how long has this been happening?
Yes.
We need to tell the world. So come
and,
on, please.
And so let me ask you, we got to go to break real quickly, John. Is Hillary Clinton a hero, a traitor, or presidential material? With her email stuff. Okay, that's a rhetorical question. We don't have to get an answer from John. We'll be right back with John McAfee. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to John McAfee, candidate for the Libertarian nomination. The nominating convention is going to be held in Orlando beginning tomorrow. They're going to choose who the presidential nominee will be. They'll be on the ballot probably in all 50 states. And whether John McAfee wins or loses a nomination, whether he wins or loses a presidency, I hope we do not lose his voice in this important issue about cybersecurity. This is a vital issue. This is a tool that the government is using to control us. Winston Churchill said, after he went to war with the Germans the second time, he said, the Germans are either at your feet or at your throat. Well, you know what? It's more true of the government. The government is either at your feet or at your throat. And the tool with which they will control us, or we will control them, is the internet and technology. It's vital that we understand the implications of these technologies. It's vital that we have somebody who has a libertarian perspective telling us the truth about the real implications of this. And real quickly, before we go back to John, just want to remind you, we've got Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine, 20% off. We've extended that sale. I don't know how much longer that's going to last, but again, that is our nascent iodine. A great time to stock on, stock up on that at InfoWarsLife.com. Also, we have Super Male Vitality back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com after being sold out for over a month. Check out the products there. That's how we support the operation. Now, let's go back to John McAfee. John, I want to ask you about the intelligence issues. I talked briefly while we lost contact with you about what's going on with the FISA. Everybody is understands a little bit about this, but talk to us about what we're seeing happening. You got involved with the demands from the FBI for data from the iPhone of the San Bernardino shooters, but now we've learned that they are also already leaning on car manufacturers to turn over all this information. How do we control this politically?
What has happened is the FBI, and not just the FBI, all of the government covert agencies and many of the police organizations are attempting to gain more control over access to our private information. The FBI wanted Apple to create a special master key that only the FBI would have so that the FBI could open any phone. Well, I've been around for in technology for 50 years. It was a software key. You can't keep that secret for more than 2 weeks. Everybody in the world would have it.
Yes, yes.
So the government is overreaching in an unconstitutional, immoral, and certainly illegal way in attempting to control us. Because really, what is information? If you know everything about the populace, then you can control the populace. I mean, this is the philosopher's stone of every dictator, and this is what our government is trying to do. Well, I won't have that. So when I offered to hack the phone, I knew I could get a team together to do it. I was really pointing to the fact that I knew the FBI could do it themselves.
which they did. They said with the help of a foreign hacker, which they paid $1.2 million, offered to do it for free.
Yes.
So we are, as a nation, ruled by a government that is so powerful and corrupt, it is out of control. And the FBI was just one representative sample of what was happening. So I stepped in and said, no, I'm not having this shit. Excuse me. I'm not having this.
Yes, absolutely. Knowledge is power. And if they have knowledge of everything that you do, they have complete power over
they
you.
They have power.
We're out of time. I wish we had more time. Okay. John McAfee, if you want to find out more information about him, go to bealibertarian.com. Mr. McAfee, best of luck to you this weekend. Whatever happens, I hope we do not lose your voice in this important issue over privacy. And it is not only a legal and constitutional issue, it is a moral issue. People need to understand this, and they need to hear from someone like John McAfee who can call the bluff of these liars who are telling us we have to give up our liberty for security. Tonight, InfoWars Nightly News at 7 Central. We also have a Ask Me Anything session at 7.